Next up is a game that already has history with the show, Final Fantasy IV. If you remember, this game was set to be part of episode 7 and on, and I had 4 episodes worth of content already recorded of it. But then the save battery of my GBA copy became faulty and the file I was using erased itself, so I had to shelve the entire thing. But since then, I've gained the means to record PSP games, so I can now use my complete collection version for it. This version of the game is the one I've played the least, ignoring the most recent remaster, which was announced months after I started recording this version. I'd even played more of the WonderSwan port than this version. I think by the time the PSP version was released in 2011, I was having a little FF4 burnout. In the space of 5 years, we'd had the GBA version with extra content, then the DS remake, then the sequel with constant mobile chapters being released in Japan that we'd hear about, then the Western WiiWare release of the sequel, and then this. Also, I'd first played FF4 Advance a little later in 2007, so all this was across 4 years for me. Bear in mind, the most recent update to an old Final Fantasy before the PSP version was the DS remake of FF4, so most of us were expecting a remake of FF5 next, like how it went with the GBA ports, but instead it was another FF4 version. So I bought it at the time, the special edition even, but it just disappeared into my collection until this year. As for my personal history with the game, being in the UK, we never got the Super Nintendo Final Fantasies until their PS1 ports, which for me came after playing the entire PS1 trilogy but before FF10. This was never a series I was going to do in order for the show. I pretty much know already where I rank most of them compared to each other, so I can keep things unexpected. And I was always set on this game being the first one I'd play for the show. It just feels like the most neutral game in the series, if that makes sense. It feels a lot more modern and accessible than the 3 that came before it, but it's also not the massive undertaking that later games will be. Like, there was no way for my first Final Fantasy on the show it was gonna involve doing a perfect save of 10 or 12. Some are just too much work to justify when you only have 16 subscribers. Plus, it had to be a main numbered game first. No way was I gonna start Final Fantasy with one of those spin-offs with the stupid names, like Pictlogica, Worldwide Words, Extremis Wacka Prolapsium, or Vincent's Gunny's Sad Lost Episode. But that brings me on to the perfect save. What that constitutes differs person by person and game by game. What my own personal perfect save for this specific game includes: all permanent party members brought to level 99, all permanent party members HP and MP maxed out at 9999 and 999 respectively, 100% bestiary, at least one of every enemy in the game killed, all summons and other such skills obtained, finally, every single treasure in the game found. This game has a limited inventory, so I will not be aiming for maxing out every item this time. Also, since stats other than HP and MP are pretty much random at level up, I'm not paying them any mind. If I can't max them all in a manageable, non-RNG way, it's not worth the effort. That's something that will also apply to FF9 should I ever get around to that one. 7, 8 and 10, you will get to see me stat maxing hell should I ever get to them. Well, 7 won't be too hard with that, but moving on. Next is the final question I need to cover. Why this version in particular? Why not the new remaster or the DS remake? First I'll cover the remake. The DS version is its own beast, with new game mechanics, boss strategies and all that. I'll be considering its own separate game that I would also like to do in the future, but not before doing the 2D version first. This also applies to the 2D and 3D versions of FF3, by the way. Secondly, as I said earlier, I started recording this back in January of 2021, half a year before the new remasters were announced. I was never gonna start this over again a third time. The other reason is that 5 of the remasters are missing content. The GBA ports of 1, 2 and 4 through 6 all added extra post-game content, which the new remasters chose to not bring over. And since my goal in these is to complete all available content in the game, all the remasters with the sole exception of the FF3 one are useless to me for this show. One last thing I should point out that isn't obvious on the title screen. Thanks to the way I recorded this, certain blue colours used for text windows in the world map screen have this strange flashing effect that may affect certain people sensitive to it. I'm not sure myself if it would cause that, not having that sensitivity, but I wanted to bring it up just in case that is a problem. If watching this video does make you unwell, I'd suggest just skipping my videos on this game, or have them off screen and just listen if you already know the game off by heart. I don't know what causes this flashing, so I don't know how to fix it. These are recorded by hooking my PSP up to the TV through an Elgato and then zooming the footage in afterwards. With all of that stuff out of the way, let's begin. On starting a new game, we fade on a fleet of airships flying north. One soldier tells the captain in blue that they will arrive in the kingdom of Baron shortly. Cecil.
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 My name is Cecil.
Cecil, not Cecil, gives a half-hearted answer, and other soldiers take notice of how down he is. But then all are after what they just did. We see a flashback to them in the town Mysidia, killing some of its mages and knocking away the Elder to steal their crystal. When one of them says that the Red Wings were formed to protect people and not murder them, Cecil tells him to stop. He repeats the reason he was given for the raid by the King, that Baron needs the crystal to prosper and the Mycidians knew too much about them. But it's clear that even Cecil doesn't buy it, but has to follow orders. After this, the ship comes under attack by monsters and we get to see two automated fights. First are three floating eyeballs who Cecil take out at once with a red fang. Then a single Zoo that he kills with a blue fang. After the fight, a soldier remarks on the recent increase in monsters, which makes Cecil wonder if this is divine punishment for their actions. They then land in Baron. At the castle gates, the captain of the guards, Bygon, meets Cecil. After Cecil makes a comment showing pity for the Mycidians, Bygon gets a bit funny with him and takes him to the king. Outside the throne room, Bygon goes in alone first. He tells the king that Cecil is questioning his authority and can't be trusted anymore. The king already expected this and doesn't care as long as he gets the crystals. He then has Bygon bring Cecil in. Cecil hands over the water crystal and is dismissed without even a thanks. Cecil is about to leave but turns back and questions the king's intentions as their recent orders have been lowering his men's morale. The king immediately accuses Cecil of dissension and strips him of his command of the Red Wings. He has a new job for Cecil, to kill an Eidolon living in the nearby Mist Valley and deliver a Carnelian signet to the village Mist. Then there's this fucking prick who barges in and inflicts himself onto my gaming experience. For having Cain stick up for him, Cecil is punished further by having Cain forced into the party for the mission. Cecil apologises to Cain, who deserves no such kindness, and Cain just responds by saying that the king will surely forgive them both once they complete their mission. He tells Cecil to get some rest and walks off to the right. First thing I do now I finally have control is turn on the dash so I don't have to hold another button all the time to not move painfully slow. Then I swap the music from arrangement to original. I'll talk about the arranged soundtrack more if I get to the DS version, but for the most part I just prefer the SNES music for a lot of these tracks. The arranged soundtrack is nowhere near the level of improvement that the first two games got for their arrangements. You can follow Cain for a chat, don't know who'd want to talk to him, but okay. We do learn a little about the two though. Cecil became a Dark Knight and trained with a dark sword at the King's request, while Cain became a dragoon to be like his dad who died when he was young. We also see that they have a little friendly rivalry going on. I then leave for the south. In this room towards the rightmost exit is a switch I can push that opens a door to chests containing an ether, 480 gil, and a tent. If I take the right exit, it leads to a room with another switch to Baron's Sacred Treasures, but this arsehole stood in front of it and won't shift. Returning to the previous room and taking the left exit leads to a scene where Cecil is stopped by Rosa, his girlfriend. This is one of the very few games in the series where the main couple are already together before the game's events even begin. She's glad to see Cecil is unharmed, but he's not in the mood for talking, so she'll visit him later. I leave to the south and then head north to the Western Tower to be stopped by Cid. Every Final Fantasy, starting with the second, has a character named Cid, and this Cid is my favourite. Cid likes to be everyone's dad, so he warns Cecil about worrying Rosa again. Also, this script is based on the GBA version with some touch-ups, and one of the localizers responsible was a Something Awful user, as you can tell from this line. Cid's fuming that the king took Cecil's position from him. He's also not a fan of the king's recent decisions. He didn't build Baron's airships for the purpose of killing innocent people. It's not just them, people in town are talking about it too. He realises the time and heads home to his daughter before she gets pissed off at him being late. Next to the tower you can visit the infirmary and see that the Red Wings are still torn up over what they did. In the southwest we can also see that they took a few Mycidian prisoners. I go into the tower and up a few floors to Cecil's room. He gets in bed, under the covers in full armour with spikes everywhere. Cecil wonders about what happened to the king, but still believes he can't defy him. He raised himself and Cain as his own, and as we find in the DS version, he literally adopted Cecil. Rosa shows up, but Cecil can't face her. She brings up how unusual it is for him to be sent on another mission right away after returning from another. Cecil tries brushing her off at first, but gives in and tells her about what he did in Mycidia. He says this is his fate as a Dark Knight, and that he soon won't even feel any emotion towards it. Rosa tries telling him that that won't happen, but Cecil just calls himself a coward instead. Rosa gets a bit fed up and tells him that the Cecil she loves wouldn't whimper like that. Now, I've already mentioned that the two's relationship predates the events of the game, but I've always got the feeling that there's still a bit of emotional distance on Cecil's side. The line about her loving Cecil has him turn around as if it was surprising to hear it, and there's something else not in this video, but in the next episode. If I forget to bring it up, feel free to never let me live it down. But also, after she leaves, Cecil says to himself that him being a Dark Knight will keep them apart. So based on his comment about soon not feeling remorse, it's possible that being a Dark Knight slowly drains the emotions or conscience and will eventually leave them as just a soldier and nothing else. But that also brings up a few questions that I'll save for later episodes. Basically what I'm getting at is that it seems Rosa is doing most of the heavy lifting in their relationship. The next morning, Cecil and Cain meet up and get going. We then get a Star Wars-esque story scroll telling us most of what we already know. The only truly important part of it is the big moon in the corner. It's one of the game's more iconic scenes, but I've always been indifferent towards it. It's strange, a lot of what people class as the most epic or iconic moments across the SNES trilogy, I've never really cared for. My favourite moments tend to be elsewhere in those games. I won't say all of them so as not to spoil them if I ever get to those games, but I will give you one. I've never liked that fucking opera. I do like this version of the main Final Fantasy theme that plays here though. It's actually one of my favourites. Definitely my favourite version out of the 16-bit games. After that's done, I get put on the world map. But the first thing I do is walk right into Baron Town. Directly right from the entrance near the inn is a potion hidden in a pot. Inside the inn we can see that even though Cecil is basically second to the king, people are afraid of him because he walks around in pure black spiky armor with horns and no visible face. Near the beds is another potion in a pot. I obsessively check every single pot whenever I play this game, even if I know there's nothing in one. In the back room of the inn, I can inspect these swords on the wall to open a door to three chests containing eye drops, a tent, and gnomish bread. Even the people in the bar are afraid of Cecil. North from the inn, there's a potion in another pot next to a house. The weapon and armour shops are locked right now for some reason. The building to the left contains the Devil's Road, a portal connecting Baron and Mysidia, but the Mysidians closed their end off after the attack, so it's useless right now. The stairs here lead to the training room. It just contains a load of NPCs who teach me the game mechanics. Also down here is this rabbit guy, Naming Way. He's in every town and talking to him can let you rename party members. I generally don't like renaming characters in RPGs, with one single exception, and I especially hate when people try to be funny in Let's Plays with wacky new names, or especially just naming them references to other things. Naming Tidus Meg Ryan will never be funny anymore. That comparison is at least a decade and a half old. You may as well be making all your base jokes at that point. To the left of that building is another locked door and some stairs to Sid's house. Inside, his daughter will ask Cecil to tell Sid to stop doing all-nighters. He's also been arguing with townspeople bad-mouthing the king. Sid can be seen sleep-talking about his newest creation. To the right of the weapon shop is Rosa's house. She's not in, but her mother is. She doesn't seem to approve of Cecil. Also, she looks 100 years old despite the fact that Rosa is only 19. To the north of Rosa's house, I find the one kid in town who thinks Cecil is cool. And behind him is a dancer. Okay, I've got to ask. Was anyone who was playing this game new in the early 90s actually turned on by 16-bit sprite spinning in place? Because even for the time, that sounds kind of desperate. Next to her, I go down some steps into the water and follow the floor just outside the city walls. Certain unmarked spots on the floor here contain a tent and a bronze hourglass. Returning to Rosa's house, I cross a bridge to the right that also leads outside the walls. I run into a hidden passage in the trees and follow them to some grass containing a hidden phoenix down, a second phoenix down, and a gold needle. That's all treasures collected in Baron. I can now leave and get killing the available monsters to add to my bestiary. One thing this game does really well is hinting at things using the in-game levels and stats. Normally in an RPG, you'd start at level 1, but Cecil and Cain here are already seasoned warriors, so they begin at level 10. First enemies they end up fighting are Helldivers. These are very simple, weak enemies that only take a single hit from either character to kill. In the forest south of Baron, my next new enemy is the Floating Eye, also only take a single hit to kill. The very next fight is my first against goblins in a sword rat. Goblins are the biggest pushovers in the game, with only 6 HP. I don't think I've ever seen a goblin survive a single hit in any playthrough I've done of this game. Sword rats are the most dangerous enemy in this area, with the most HP and strongest attacks, but they're still not a threat. This was also where I got to show off each character's unique skill. Cecil has darkness, which has him fire a dark wave across the screen that hits all enemies at the cost of some HP. So not only does it affect his personality over time, but being a dark knight slowly kills him too. Cain is the first character to have the standard Dragoon jump. He'll jump in the air, then a little later drop down on an enemy. The trade-off is a longer wait for more damage. This move is literally the only reason I ever put up with this fucker. I'll get into my grudge against Cain in a later episode after we've seen how his story pans out across the game first. A little southwest of Baron is a Chocobo Forest. These are always hexagonal. When it comes to Chocobo Forest, I always have to remember that for all treasures, everyone hides a single Gisal Green somewhere in the grass. In here, there are white chocobo that will refill MP. Thing is, neither Cecil or Cain even have MP in the first place. The normal yellow chocobos I can ride across the world map. They prevent enemy encounters and can run across shallow water. Thing is, they're kind of useless in this game. Most of the forests are out of your way and a bigger pain to reach than your destination. This is the easiest one to reach and the only enemy fights it bypasses are against complete wimps. Running over rivers is also never used once for anything. No hidden secrets or anything like that. That's everything for the Baron area covered, so I head west in between these mountains and then north to a cave entrance. This leads into the Mist Cave. Okay, so I had no idea how to cover these dungeons without being either confusing or really long and boring. So what I'll do is show you a map here of the dungeon. No PSP map, sorry, but this GBA one has the exact same layout. I'll show the route I took through the room, and then detail the enemies and treasure found on the way. This is a new thing just to this video, so I hope people let me know if it works, or if I should just go back to my old way of doing things. So from the start, I go east, up some stairs, northwest and downstairs, and right up some more, then go all the way north to my first chest. Then east across a bridge and northeast to my second chest. I go back a little and go south, then south again at the fork and follow the path west and then north to the third chest. I backtrack to the fork and go east for the final chest, and then north to the end. In my first fight here, Cecil reaches level 11. Before I reach the first chest, a voice tells the two to turn back, but we ignore it. The first chest is just a potion. The second is eye drops. The third is a tent, and the fourth is another potion. I somehow got so close to the end without fighting a single new enemy, so I stop here and just run left and right until I get them. It's here I get a back attack with six goblins. Back attacks are just the worst. Not only do they swap the rows your party members are on, so physical attackers are on the back row where they do less damage, but it also starts out all your party members with a completely empty ATB bar, and it takes an eternity for those bars to fill up and let you get an attack in. And with six enemies back attacking you, you get hit about a million times before you can do anything. There is an option to swap rows in battle, but that uses up a character's turn, and after the wait for that turn, I really don't want to waste it. The very next fight has the two new enemies I was after, Eyewing Moth and Lava. There's nothing to say about them, they don't even get a single hit in before I kill them all. Cain reaches level 11 from this fight. With those killed, I can keep moving north to the exit. As I cross another bridge, the voice tells us to turn back again, and Cain believes it might be the Eidolon thereafter. Then right in front of the exit, the voice stops us once again and gives them the chance to turn back. I refuse and the mist begins gathering to form into our first boss fight, the Mist Dragon. It's the first enemy we've fought so far that breaks 3-digit HP, having 465, but it's still not a threat. It mainly hits me with weak physical attacks, but the main threat is its gimmick. From 4 to 7, the first bosses of each game share this gimmick, a second mode they'll enter that, when attacked, will make them respond with a very strong counter-attack. In this case, the dragon will phase into pure mist, and if attacked, the attack will miss and it will respond with the powerful freezing mist. This can make Cain a liability, as his jump is the most damaging attack I have right now, but I can't control when it lands, so it could turn into mist after he jumps and before he lands, and I can't do anything about it. When it does turn into mist, you just have to wait for it to turn back. You could use the time to heal, but I've never felt the need to. After it turns back, a couple more hits kill it. With it dead, I can exit the cave and move east to the village of mist. But before I enter, I walk back and forth for a new enemy, the Desert Sahagin. I get my first preemptive strike here, the opposite of a back attack. All party members get their turns immediately at the start of the battle. I have found though that it's not quite the advantage for me that the back attack is for the enemy. It feels like they have to wait less than I do to get their first turns. With them dead, I enter the village. I take a few steps in and the ring starts glowing. It turns out the ring contains a load of bombs that set the village on fire. In earlier versions of the game, they straight up called it a bomb ring, which made Cecil and Cain look like massive idiots for being surprised when it goes off. To be fair, Cecil does have a very low intelligence stat. The two can't believe what they've been tricked into, but they get distracted by a crying girl. She says that her mum's dragon died, so she died too. Cain says he's heard of people like her mother, summoners. Cecil drops them in it when he realises out loud that they killed the girl's mother by killing the Mist Dragon. The girl doesn't take that bit of info well, but Cain ignores her when he figures out that the king wanted to wipe out all the summoners, but when he says that means they'll have to kill the girl too, that's it for Cecil. He refuses to keep killing people for the king. Cain was just testing Cecil and hoping they'd feel the same, so he'll help Cecil stand against Baron. But the two of them can't do it alone and they'll need more allies. They also need to get Rosa away from Baron too. Cecil thanks him, but Cain says he isn't doing this just for Cecil, which makes him raise an eyebrow. But more important right now is the girl. They decide to take her with her. They try talking her over, but as you might expect, she doesn't appreciate these two armoured guys who killed her mum and burned down her home, telling her she's coming with them. So they end up in a fight with her. What also might not help is me making Cecil cut her right in the face. To try and get rid of us, she summons Titan, who uses Earthquake. The earthquake causes a landslide that cuts off mist from the east. Looking for Cecil, he and the girl end up on the east side. She's alive, but Cain is missing. Good. He doesn't have time to look for Cain, so just takes the girl with him and hopes he survived. I don't. I also took all of his equipment before entering mist. Every time a party member is going to be leaving, I remove their equipment just before. The only way I can go is north, which leads into a desert. In here I get another new enemy, the Hundlegs. While I appreciate that Cain is no longer around, being reduced to just Cecil is a bit of a pain since it makes fights take longer. Cecil gets all the experience to himself though, and reaches level 12 from this fight. To the east is an oasis with a town by it. This is Kaipo. As soon as I enter, Cecil takes over and automatically walks into the inn. Seeing how injured the girl is, the innkeeper lets him stay for free. Cecil puts her in one of the beds, but she still hates him for what he did and can't look at him. Cecil simply apologises and says he understands if she never forgives him, but he still wants her to let him keep her safe. He doesn't get an answer, so he just goes to bed too. That night, four soldiers from Baron arrive. The general demands Cecil hand over the girl to be killed on the king's orders. Cecil refuses, so a fight starts. Two new enemies. I have three Baron soldiers and a single general. I start by killing two of the soldiers with a single attack each. However, my next target is the general. If I kill all the soldiers first, the general will flee and he won't be added to the bestiary. It's not a huge setback. He has more health than the soldiers and he takes less damage being on the back row, but his only move is to command all remaining soldiers to attack at once. And since there's only one left, I'm only suffering single-digit damage a turn. Once he dies, it's just a single hit on the final soldier to win. I also get a lot more XP for killing the general. The girl asks Cecil if he's okay, and he tells her not to worry, as he promises to protect her. He's finally gained her trust, so she gives him her name, Rydia. She also joins the party. The next morning, she's much more energetic and gets Cecil up and out of bed. The old woman in the right of the inn tells us out of nowhere about this woman Anna, who ran away, and that her and her father, the sage teller, used to be close. Rydia starts at level 1, being just 7 years old and very inexperienced. We need to keep her safe for her to have any chance of surviving and getting stronger, so I move her to the back row where she'll take less damage. There are only two possible layouts of party rows. I can have 3 on the front and 2 in the back, or 2 in the front and 3 in the back, changed by selecting the row option. Upstairs is a scholar who tells us of the kingdoms Damcian, which is north of here, and Fabul, which is east of Damcian. He can't reach either because the underground waterway to Damcian is being blocked off by an angry old man. Leaving the inn has the first guy I talked to tell me that a woman from Baron passed outside of town and was taken to rest in someone's house. To the right, over a bridge, is an ether in a pot. The guy nearby tells me Kaipo and the entire desert surrounding it is in Dancium territory. I enter the house here and the old lady inside says the woman from Baron has desert fever and keeps repeating the name Cecil. Of course, it's Rosa. Her fever is so bad that she can't even recognise that Cecil is right in front of her. The old man, just staring at her, says the only way to cure it is with a sand pearl, found only in a cave where an antlion lives. Cecil leaves the house and the first thing he does is watch another dancer. Once again, was there anyone out there who was actually thrilled by that 3 or 4 pixel tall sprite that could be interpreted as a bare leg just moving up and down the screen? And that's about it. From the weapon shop, I could upgrade Rydia's rod to either a staff or a bow, but the minuscule upgrade with the staff wouldn't be worth the money, and I really fucking hate bows in this game. I leave town and it's time to kill some more enemies and build Rydia up a bit. The first fight I get into pits me against a sandworm, the strongest enemy in this desert. This could be a problem keeping Rydia alive at level 1. She has white and black magic commands, but no spells yet. She also has a single summon, Chocobo. Lucky for me, I get 2 hits in with Cecil and kill it before it can do anything. The Chocobo summon is quite weak and very quickly rendered obsolete, but early on it's still good for some decent damage. My second fight gets Rydia to level 2, teaching her the Blizzard spell. After that she reaches level 3 and learns Cure. They did a good job having Rydia start out needing to be babysat, but having a lot of potential that comes out very quickly with her fast level ups and learning these spells. Like it was always there, it's only now it comes out. Then in my next fight, Cecil reaches level 13 and Rydia reaches level 4 and learns Sight. Sight shows you the entire world map and every location you've already visited. The gnomish bread item I picked up earlier has the same use. I will say it is a bit of a pain that viewing the items is locked behind the spell or item. It's thanks to that that I spent over 10 years without knowing how to view the map, thinking there wasn't even one in the game at all. Not to mention, a full view of the map with locations was only added starting with the GBA version. Before that, it would zoom out and give a slightly larger view of the area you're standing in. 2 fights later, Rydia reaches level 5 and learns Thunder. At this point I decide I'm done levelling and it's time to move on. The underground waterway is to the northeast of Kaipo. We start with the south end. This is the first dungeon in the game with multiple floors to cover. I start by heading directly north over this bridge to 2 chests. I then return to the entrance and then go left across another bridge and south to the 3rd chest. Then it's north across a bridge, right across another bridge, and ignore the chest I crossed out, it's not there in this version, it's exclusive to the Japanese exclusive Final Fantasy IV Easy Type in the US SNES version. Then northeast across 2 more bridges and south into the water, north to the 5th chest and then southwest into a waterfall leading to a hidden room with a few extra chests. Then it's just backtracking to around the 4th chest and running to the exit in the northwest corner. Ignore those names by the chests, they're from the very first English translation on the Super Nintendo. The first chest contains a potion, and the second a maiden's kiss. The third chest contains a tent, and at the end of the bridge going north is an old man. He recognises Cecil's dark sword and begs for his help. He says that he needs to get his daughter back from Dancian after she was deceived by a wicked bard. Cecil recognises him as Teller, and Teller notices that Rydia is a summoner, so she can help too. He can't get through alone because of the monster in the lake further ahead. Teller then joins the party. In keeping with storytelling through stats, Teller joins at level 20, double Cecil's starting level, showing how much more experienced he is. However, his actual stats show that he's long out of practice. His stats are very bad for a famous master of magic, and sometimes on level up, some of his stats may even go down, so he's not in the best of health either. He's forgotten most of his spells too, only having a basic selection of white and black magic. What is strange is that he starts with Cura, but has forgotten Cure, the lower level version of the spell. I finally get into a fight here, and most of the enemies here are new, starting with Killer Fish. Being water based, most enemies here have a weakness to lightning spells. Both Rydia and Tella know Thunder, but MP is very limited at this point, and I very rarely use most of my healing items like Aethers and Elixirs, saving them for a later moment that never comes. From this fight, Rydia reaches level 6. The next fight gives me Fang Shell and Amoeba for the bestiary. The SNES era of this series had some really out there enemies. The Amoebas are odd, but they're also nothing compared to shit like the giant monk heads from FF6. The fourth chest contains an iron amulet. I equip it to Tella since his arms are bare for a slight increase in both defense and magic defense. After my next fight, Rydia reaches level 7 and learns Hold. The secret grotto behind the waterfall has three chests inside. They contain a dry ether, an X potion, and a phoenix down. Two of those are high level healing items we won't be seeing normally for a while. On the way back, the next new enemy I face is the Gigantoad. I should also point out Tella has an ability I rarely use, Recall. This makes him cast a random one of the spells he's forgotten over the years. Since it's random, I prefer not to rely on it. That's all for this floor, and I go down the stairs to floor B2. As for this next room, I head straight north to the other end and then downstairs into the water. Then southwest and north to reach the first chest. Back into the water and south and up some stairs to go west past a bridge to the second chest. I go down the bridge I passed, then west and north to a save room. Out of the other end I go west and north for the third chest. Then finally, south into the water and east, then north to the door out. After my second fight on this floor, Rydia reaches level 8 and learns a sleep spell. The first chest contains a potion and the second an ether. Then things are uneventful until I reach the save room. These allow me to save in dungeons, as opposed to the world map where I can save anywhere. I can also use tents and cottages here to heal the entire party at once. But for this first one, we get the free, since Tella brought his own tent. Cecil and Tella talk while Rydia sleeps. I'm so sorry for how awful this looks with the blue filter over the screen. Tella talks about Rydia's potential, which we've already seen with how quickly she's learning spells. He also mentions how he reminds her of his daughter Anna when she was Rydia's age. He reveals that she was never deceived by the bard. They eloped because Tella didn't approve of their marriage. When Tella asks why Cecil needs to go to Damsion, we get another hint at Cecil being more closed off emotionally when he refers to Rosa simply as a friend. Cecil asks about the monster they'll have to face soon, which Tella describes as having 8 huge tentacles. Tella is in a rush because he feels they're on a time limit before something horrible happens, though he prays he's wrong. After leaving the save room to the north, Rydia reaches level 9 from the very next fight. The final chest on this floor contains an ice rod, which I equip on Rydia straight away. It has the added benefit of being able to cast Blizzard for free when you use it as an item in battle while equipped. I didn't know this at all until about 2010, watching Sir Ron Lionheart's Let's Play of the game, if anyone else remembers him. My next fight has Cecil reach level 14, then nothing else happens until I leave the room to be free. This floor is much more straightforward. I go west, south, east and south to the first chest, then west to the second. Then backtrack east and north, then all the way west and then north to the exit. Simple. The first chest has 580 gil inside. The second contains a bomb fragment, an item that casts fire when used. And I make it through the entire floor without getting in a single fight. This puts me back on B2, but a different section. Here I go north and get the first chest on my way. Then to the west of the exit is a hidden path in the wall I can take around to the east side and then head south for the second chest. After this I just backtrack and take the exit. My first fight here gets me some red moose. These are the first flans I fight in the game. Flans are a right pine? Fuck, the right pine in the arse. Flans are a right pain in the arse because you can't just shut your brain off and wait for your party to beat them to death. They all have extremely high physical defense, so you just have to use the right magic to deal decent damage to them. A lot of the time the colour will give it away. These are red, so I set them on fire to kill them. The first chest contains another potion. The second contains a feathered cap. I give it to Rydia as an upgrade over the leather cap she joins with. On the way to the exit, Rydia reaches level 10 and learns poison. At 7 years old, in about 20 minutes she's reached the same level that seasoned knights Cecil and Cain have reached by the time they were 20 and 21 respectively. It also finally got her to break triple digit HP. Another new enemy on the way back, the zombie. Cecil's dark swords are worthless against these, his normal attack only doing 1 damage. But all undead enemies are weak to fire, so Tella is the most useful character for them right now. The exit takes me to the north side of the underground waterway. I start by going north until I reach some stairs that lead to the first two chests. Then back up those stairs I go east over a bridge, ignore the exit and go south down more stairs for the third and fourth chests. Then I take the exit. The first contains an ether and the second an Antarctic Wind, an item that casts Blizzard when used. The third chest has a bronze hourglass and the fourth has a shadow blade. This is a big upgrade for Cecil over the dark sword he starts with, giving 10 extra strength. I reach the exit, which puts me back on the world map for a few seconds to give me the chance to save and use a tent. I then enter the northern cave entrance to reach the underground falls. No need for a map, I just walk south and drop down the waterfall. This puts me in a new room. This is the simplest to explain so far. I take the stairs up and go south, open the two chests, then go north to the exit. During this, Rydia reaches level 11. I get two new enemies in one fight here, the Tiny Mage and Sahagin. Sahagin is nothing special, but Tiny Mages can be a pain. They have more HP than the other enemies and a lot of magic defense, so only Cecily is useful for them right now. When attacked, they like to cast Osmos, which steals MP from party members. Good thing for me, they also like to use it on Cecil, who doesn't have MP. But from Teller, they take 20, which is a big chunk of his 90 MP, and I need that for the boss up ahead. They like to respond to physical attacks with Hold, which temporarily paralyzes. The chests contain the Hades Helm and Hades Gloves, another improvement over Cecil starting Dark Helm and Dark Gloves. I next get a fight with alligators. If you remember the older versions of this game, you may remember the alligator enemy type as having quite large sprites compared to most other enemies at this point, so why do they look so puny here? The answer is low budget. This version of the game reuses enemy sprites from the PSP versions of FF1 and FF2 for enemies that were already in those games. Also, this fight got settled to level 15. Two more steps and I get the next level of Gigantoad, the Toadger. They're stronger but still not a threat. Their attack only does one damage to everyone and Cecil can still kill them with one attack. They do like to cast a Toad spell, which is one of the many banes of my life in this game. Toad makes you weak and prevents you from using any ability other than casting Toad itself. The only cure is casting Toad on the Toad character or using the Maiden's Kiss item. Lucky I already had enough from chests after the fight was done. I then go through the exit into Underground Lake B1. This is another simple one. Straight east into two chests, then north to stairs into the water, and north some more to the boss. One chest contains Hades armor, an upgrade over Cecil's default dark armor. The other contains Hermes sandals, an item that casts float. After that I reach this tentacle, heal up, and actually use ethers thanks to those bastard tiny mages. Approaching the tentacle has us surrounded on all sides and starts the game's second boss battle. The Octomammoth has 2350 HP. It only has a single weak physical attack. Its main weaknesses are the lightning and dark elements, which makes this quite easy for us. I simply have Cecil attack and have Rydia summon Chocobo and Teller cast Thunder, only stopping to heal if needed. A cool touch is that as it loses HP, it will also gradually lose its tentacles, with new sprites every time. Like Mist Dragon, it's a very easy boss that I've never died against once, but it does take longer. For such a simple fight, it sometimes feels like it takes an eternity for the thing to just hurry up and die. In the end, it's Cecil who gets the final blow. Rydia reaches level 12 and learns Warp. With it dead, I just run into the waterfall to end up back on the world map outside Damcyan. Damcyan Castle is slightly north, but as I get close to it, the red wings fly over and blow the shit out of it. As I enter, I ignore the dead guard on the steps and run around the right side outside the walls. It leads to a door to the Damcyan Castle dungeon. There's a soldier who was blinded in the attack, begging me not to let them take the treasure before he dies and blinks away, letting me push the switch to open the door. I can walk through these walls to the three chests in the cells containing a crossbow, feathered cap, and a ruby ring. I then take the stairs on the left to do some more looting. Six chests and three pots containing an antidote, high potion, holy arrows, ether, phoenix down, gold needle, more holy arrows, iron arrows, and some eye drops. Now let's actually check up on these people. The two guards outside are dead, so I head in. One guy in here says they stole the crystal. I head further upstairs to find the Red Wings looted this room before I could. Bastards. One guy is trying to drag himself to a healing pot upstairs, but he's not gonna make it. They did miss one chest though, with a tent inside. Going upstairs takes us to a body that's not like the others. Teller recognises her as Anna. Then that bard he was talking about shows up. Teller blames him for Anna's death and we get an automated battle. All Teller can do here is punch him because I took his equipment beforehand. We also get the infamous "you spoony bard" line. I know it's tradition to keep the line in ever since the original dodgy SNES translation, but to be honest, I wouldn't mind if they dropped it in the future for a more accurate translation. Thing is, it was funny, 15 years ago, to bring up the quote for how out of place it is in the situation, but now it's just kind of old. This in-joke is just a month younger than I am, and as I'm writing this, I'm less than a month away from turning 29. The thing is pushing 30 now. The bard keeps begging Teller to stop and listen, but Teller just keeps trying to kill him. That is, until Anna shouts at him to stop. She's still barely alive for now. She reveals that the bard, Edward, is Damcyan's prince. As much as she loves Edward, she couldn't be happy without Teller's approval, so she was about to return to him when the Red Wings attacked. They were led by some new guy called Golbez. He was incredibly powerful and helped kill everyone to take Damcyan's crystal. Edward's parents were killed and Anna took the arrows that were meant for him. Hearing that Anna loved Edward enough to give a life for him does give Teller pause, but it doesn't last because Anna dies soon after. Teller demands Edward tell him what he knows about Golbez. He just showed up to Baron after Cecil left and immediately became the new captain of the Red Wings. He can't keep going because he's crying too much, which pisses Teller off. He swears revenge and goes to leave. Cecil tries to stop him, but Teller isn't having it and swats Cecil away, running off alone and leaving the party. Even Rydia has no sympathy and tells him to knock off for crying because he's too old for it. Because her mother is dead too, you know, and she isn't crying anymore. She ignores that at this point her mother's probably been dead a few days at least, depending on how long the travel from Mr. Damsian took, and that Anna's only been dead for like a minute. A bit unfair of her. Of course, Edward's going to be a bit hysterical in the moment, saying he doesn't care and he's never going to leave Anna's side. But Cecil's all about that lack of sympathy too and just fucking slaps him. Fuck your dead girlfriend, help me with my almost dead girlfriend instead. But worded a bit nicer than that. Edward can tell Cecil feels just as strongly for Rosa as he did for Anna, so he agrees to help. He says a sand pearl can be found in the Antlion's den to the east. They'll need to cross shallow water with his hovercraft to get there. With that, Edward joins the party. As they leave, Edward says one last goodbye to Anna before her body fades away for some reason. I never got that. Why don't the other dead guys surrounding her do that? When we return to the world map, we now have the hovercraft. It's like a chocobo that doesn't run away when you get out. It crosses shallow water and prevents random battles. So, continuing the trend of stats informing characters, Edward starts at level 5. He's not a hugely experienced soldier like Cecil is, so he doesn't start at level 10. But to be a travelling bard in a monster infested world, he'd need to have some combat skills. So he starts halfway between seasoned Cecil and never fought before in her life, Rydia. His main weapon are harps, but he can also equip bows. But once again, I hate bows in this game, so I never let him use them. He can also equip daggers, but I don't have any yet. I cross the shallow water to the east and go south a little to see the entrance to the Antlion's den. Now this very basic dungeon is very memorable to me, because it was the first I ever saw of this game. I get home from school to be told my grandmother has bought both Final Fantasy IV and Final Fantasy V as part of the PAL version of Final Fantasy Anthology. I didn't even know games before 7 were even on the PS1. So when I ran across the road to hers to see, this is where she was, and I took over and played the rest of the dungeon. Okay, so thanks to the layout of this room and its chests, drawing my route around this room would look a massive mess, so I'll just show the route from entrance to exit and show the order I opened these chests. The exit is simply in the southeast corner of the room and takes no effort to reach, and the chests are dotted all over in nearly every corner. The very first step I take has me battle a new enemy, the Basilisk. This is another enemy that's a lot smaller in this version compared to the previous versions. It should not be almost the same size as goblins. Edward has three abilities. There's Bard Song, which has him inflict a status effect depending on the harp he has equipped. Thing is, attacking the enemy normally can also inflict that effect and also does damage, so I just do that instead. Salve can be useful sometimes. He takes your lowest level healing item and splits the HP one would heal between the party. When it's potions like I have right now, this is worthless. But when you have better healing items, it can be good. Hide has Edward hide away from the fight. It can be useful if you know the enemy is preparing a strong attack so you can dodge it, but this ability causes more problems than it's worth. Edward automatically hides when he's low on HP. Then at the start of his next turn, he returns only to hide again. If Edward is your only living party member and gets stuck in his hiding cycle, that's it, you're fucked. You just have to sit there and wait for the enemy to kill him and get your game over. Probably the least well thought out gameplay mechanic in the game. The first chest I open gets me a spider silk, which casts slow when used on an enemy. Slow has its uses in this game, but its effectiveness really multiplies a thousandfold in this game's sequel. Second chest gets me a potion. Then it's those two chests in the bottom right for a tent and another potion. Right after that chest is my first Adamantus. It's strange seeing these early in the game and so weak. None of that incredible defense they're known for. They're also weak against ice, and since I have a free blizzard with Rydia's ice rod, they have no chance. Edward also gets the effect of his dream harp when he puts one of them to sleep, and since only physical attacks, not magic, undo sleep, this is no challenge at all. Now for the last two chests on the right side of the room. The fifth chest gets me another potion. The next fight gets Edward to level 6. Then the final chest in this room has a gold needle inside. I then take the stairs to B2. I start by going directly south to the first chest, then left into a room containing the second. Left some more and then north into some stairs that lead back to the first floor and a door to the save room. When I return, the third chest is behind those stairs. Then it's left some more for the final chest of this dungeon and then south down the middle of the room to some more stairs. There's also this entire section in the southwest part of the room that's empty and just exists to waste time. The first chest has an Antarctic wind. The second in the sub-room contains a Lamia harp, which is much better than the Dream harp. It's stronger and inflicts confuse on enemies, so now I can make them beat themselves or other enemies up for me. On the way to the third chest, my next new enemy is Leshy. I don't remember a single interesting thing about these enemies or its entire enemy type. In the next fight against the same enemy formation, Edward reaches level 7. I take those stairs to that save room, but it also has some chests of its own. A phoenix down, an ether, and an emergency exit which casts teleport and sends me to the dungeon entrance on the world map. The third chest on floor B2 has another potion, and the last has another spider silk. Soon after this, Edward reaches level 8. I go down the stairs and the next room is just a simple walk down a lot of stairs to this sinkhole. Edward says the antlion lays its eggs here. He goes to take a sand pearl when two huge pincers come out of the ground. Edward says there's no reason to worry, as antlions are docile and don't attack people. But when he tries to take a pearl, it attacks him, so we are fighting in the end. The antlion has 1100 HP, and no elemental weaknesses. It automatically counters all physical attacks with pincers, which does a decent amount of damage, but is still only a threat to Edward, who hasn't reached triple digits yet, and who I brought into the fight with only 36 HP for some reason. So I just have Edward defend, Rydia summon Chocobo, and have Cecil use Darkness, which isn't physical, so it doesn't trigger the counter. It also has a regular attack that deals very little damage. So as long as I keep this strategy up, it isn't a threat and goes down quickly. Cecil reaches level 16, Rydia reaches level 13 and learns Toad, and Edward reaches level 9. We can finally claim the Sand Pearl now. Edward wonders what caused a normally harmless creature to attack them. Cecil points out that monsters have been rapidly multiplying and becoming more aggressive, so this is probably affecting other creatures as well. He wonders if it's a sign, until Rydia says it's time to cure Rosa. On the way out, I get another new enemy. The yellow jelly is another of those flans I hate. Since they're yellow, they're weak against lightning. When I was a kid, I'd never heard of the dessert flan, so I thought the ones in this game were just ghosts, or the two eyes cut in a bedsheet kind. Killing these gets Edward to level 10. The rest of the journey out is uneventful. Back in the hovercraft and west of Damseon Castle is some shallow water that leads back to the Kaipo Desert. I return to the old couple's house and use a sand pearl on Rosa. Exposing her to the light from the sand pearl somehow cures her fever. The first thing she says is how thrilled she is that Cecil is still alive. He was reported dead in the Mist earthquake, so Rosa set out to find him. I'll come back to this in a bit. Cecil gives a quick apology for worrying her and quickly changes the subject to Golbez. First, he just repeats what we already know. He's the new Red Wings captain chosen by the king, who is still acting out of character. But something new is that Rosa believes Golbez is the one in charge, manipulating the king to get the crystals for himself. Since he already has the water crystal from Mysidia and the fire crystal from Damseon, he still needs the wind crystal from Fabul and the earth crystal from Troia. The mention of Damseon's crystal leads to Cecil introducing Edward and Rydia. Rosa says Fabul is the most likely next target, but she still isn't fully rested. Cecil tries to get her to stay in Kaipo and rest while the three of them go to Fabul. Edward points out the only way to Fabul is through Mount Hobbs and the entrance is blocked by ice. Rosa asks Rydia if she knows the fire spell. Rydia looks concerned and says she can't, which confuses Rosa as fire is the most basic beginner black magic spell there is. The conversation can't go any further as Rosa starts coughing again. Cecil once again tries to make her stay, but she's not having it. Being a white mage will make her a huge help. Edward backs her up, trying to get it through Cecil's skull that his girlfriend just wants to be with him. Cecil gives in, but first they're going to rest for the night. We now have Rosa in the party. Now it's time for that thing I said I'll get back to. So, Rosa went looking for Cecil and wound up in the desert near Kaipo after Cecil was reported dead in the Mist earthquake, right? Before the earthquake, the only way to walk to Kaipo from Baron was to go through Mist, but that path was blocked by the landslide caused by the earthquake. So that way is out of the question. There are no boats going from Baron to Kaipo, and even Cecil will say later on that Baron's sea forces are rather weak compared to the Red Wings, so a boat is out of the question. She can't take an airship because they're all owned by the Red Wings and no way would they let her go and investigate anything relating to Mist. That leaves only one solution. Rosa climbed over all those mountains to get to Kaipo. She doesn't mention leaving with any help, and we never hear of any climbing equipment, which leads me to the conclusion that she white-knuckled it over that entire mountain range and still reached Kaipo before Cecil did. Despite the distance from Baron to Kaipo being double the distance from Mr. Kaipo and 100% more mountainous. And, don't forget, news of the earthquake and Cecil's supposed death would have had to reach Baron first to prompt Rosa to look for him in the first place, giving her even less time to get to Kaipo before him. My claim earlier that Rosa is doing all the heavy lifting in the relationship is looking even likelier. But back to the plot. That night, Edward goes out alone to play his harp by the lake. It's his first chance since Anna's death to take some time to himself and let it sink in. But he's interrupted when a Sahagin comes out of a bush and attacks him. During their fight, the ghost of Anna appears to motivate him. She gives him the push he needs to kill the Sahagin and reach level 11. Anna says it's now time for her to pass to the next world. Edward begs her to stay, but she just tells him that he has to stop Golbez and fight for his kingdom before she fades away. Edward finally has his motivation, but he still doesn't know how he can actually help. We fade to the next morning. Rosa starts at level 10, same as Cecil. It's implied she became a white mage around the same time Cecil became a dark knight, so they should have an almost equal amount of experience. Rosa can equip staffs and bows. The game nods towards her being more of an archer, but I use staffs mostly because of how much I hate bows, and I should probably explain why now. Arrows are consumable, so simply having a bow is not enough. You have to also keep a stock of arrows too, and I just don't think the damage that bows do justifies all the resource management and costs of the arrows. And the best arrows are quite expensive and not worth the price. The DS version makes them better though by scrapping consumable arrows, so maybe I'll actually use them there if I get around to doing that one. I take the hovercraft to the same island the Antlion's Den is on, but keep moving east to reach Mount Hobbs. The path is frozen, as Edward said. Rose asks Riddy to just try the fire spell, but Riddy refuses. She hates fire thanks to her village being burned down. Rosa talks her around by explaining that she's the only one who can get them through, and that even more people's lives are at risk. Edward then adds that Riddy has already been a big help to them this far. Cecil says nothing. Convinced, Riddy gives fire a try and melts the ice. She also finally learns fire. The funny thing about this part is that while Rydia won't learn fire until this scene, she could still learn fire and fire aga through level grinding if you're patient enough, but she'll still talk about hating fire. So fire she hates, but even more destructive than explosive fire she's perfectly fine with. With this first screen of Mount Hobbs there are two exits. There's an optional door on the way to the main door forward. Of course I take the optional one first. It leads to the west side of the mountain, which is a single path to a dead end with a save point on the way and four chests at the end. I get my first encounter up here and it's a new enemy. The Cockatrice is the next level up from the Helldiver. Aside from white magic, Rosa has two more abilities. There's Prey, which heals a small amount of HP to the entire party for free. It's not that useful. Then there's Aim, which makes bows more accurate, so I never use it. That's right, arrows are consumable and they don't even have the accuracy to justify it without an added ability only one of the bow users has access to. The four chests on this screen contain a tent, potion, gold needle and 960 gil. Right after opening the last chest is another new enemy, the Spirit, just another one that doesn't get to pull off a single turn before I kill them. On the way out I get my next new enemy, Skeletons. These are undead so they have a big weakness to fire, even when the damage is split four ways. I return to the first room to go through that second door. In a fight with more Skeletons, Riddy reaches level 14, Rosa reaches level 11, learning the Race spell, and Edward reaches level 12. Just before I get to that door, I get my next new enemy, the Gargoyle. The main threat with them is the tornado spell that reduces the target to single digit HP. Good for me that I confuse it with Edward and make it cast tornado on itself. Going through the door takes me to the summit. I start in the bottom left and there's just one chest and some story between me and the next exit at the top of the screen. The chest contains holy arrows. Boo! As I head north we see a monk from Fabul surrounded by monsters. He kills the first two by jumping on them, but then we get an automated fight for the next three, showing him kill all three Domovoys. But the most dangerous is still to come as a bomb approaches him. This is the point where everyone else gets involved. This is the first fight in the game where we have a full 5 person party. He has 11,000 HP, which is just too much for my party right now. He has a physical attack that does quite decent damage compared to everything else I've fought so far. The main goal right now is to just keep everyone's HP high enough. After a few turns, she beefs up and I really have to make sure everyone's HP is high. Then I just keep defending to minimise the damage from the impending self-destruction. Once she blows up, she splits into 3 bombs and 3 grey bombs. I can still die here so I'm not out of it just yet. I confuse one with Edward and get Rosa and Riddia healing, while Cecil and the monk, Yang, deal with attacking. After a few turns, I take them all down and win the fight. Yang introduces himself, he says he came here with his men to train, but after they were attacked, he was the only survivor. The party introduce themselves too and let him know about Gorbaz's plan to steal Fabul's crystal. This is a problem because the monks just killed were Fabul's finest, and aside from Yang, the only remaining monks are students. Rosa works out that the attack was planned to get Fabul's best warriors out of the way and make it easier to invade. Cecil volunteers the party to help defend the crystal and doesn't let Yang talk them out of it with the excuse that it isn't their concern. Yang gives in and joins the party. Like the other experienced warriors, Yang joins at level 10. Being ambidextrous, he can equip a weapon to each of his hands. I give him a couple left over pieces of equipment I've been holding onto. I also take a look at the bestiary and find I've killed one of 15% of all enemies in the game already. After that I finally go through the exit onto the mountain's east slope. Nothing to say about this room, it's a straightforward path to the exit. In fact I make it all the way to the bottom without getting a single fight. Thing is, I've not killed all the enemies, so I hang about for some fights. There's the Blood Bones, a stronger skeleton. These are even easier to deal with now Yang comes equipped with a Flame Claw. Yang also has Kick, which hits all enemies for less damage. He has Focus, which makes him skip a turn in exchange for a stronger attack next turn. Then there's Brace, a powered up version of the Defend command. Yang's normal attack is already pretty good, so I rarely use any of these. From this fight, Rosa reaches level 12 and learns Protect, and Yang reaches level 11. Now I can leave. This puts me on the opposite side of the mountain, so sadly I have to leave the hovercraft behind on the west side. I still have a bit of a trek to Fabul. I go east a little and then north, then south again. My first fight here is my first proper fight against Domovoy, the next level up from Goblin, and Gatling Hog, the next level up from Sword Rat. Gatling Hogs are a little strong, but Domovoy are still pushovers. At the end of this forest I get going east again. On the way, Edward reaches level 13. I cross between the mountains and then south to reach a desert with a castle near it. In a fight in the desert, Cecil reaches level 17. Rather than enter the castle, I go northeast past it. On the way, Yang reaches level 12. As is usual for monks in this series, Yang has the highest HP growth and level up of all party members, so he will always have higher maximum HP than everyone else. After my next fight, Rydia reaches level 15 and learns Stop, and Rosa reaches level 13 and learns Cura. Northeast of Fabul is another Chocobo Forest. I don't get the point of this one. It's further out than Fabul is, so you have to go out of your way to reach it, and it doesn't get you to any new areas. I grab the Gasal greens in the grass and use them on this nest to summon the Fat Chocobo. He exists to store items you don't want to hold, but also don't want to throw away or sell. I drop off some things and get going back to Fabul. This time I enter. The monks at the front gate say the king is asking for Yang, but he can wait, I've got some exploring to do. I head inside and go right to the weapon shop. I buy a pair of Ice Claws and Lightning Claws for Yang and then upgrade all of Cecil's armour with a Demon Helm, Demon Armour and Demon Gloves. I give Yang a Lightning Claw and give Cecil a nice 5 extra points of defence with the new armour. I'm about to move on before I buy a second of all 3 Elemental Claws, they'll be useful. I then replace Yang's Flame Claw with a second Lightning Claw. I leave the shop and head north, then south to end up outside again. I go into the left tower and loot Azusa's Wrath from a pot and then from the chest a Bomb Fragment, Antarctic Wind and Potion. Zeus's Wrath is Thunder in Iron form. I go upstairs where there's a single White Mage and Naming Way. Then upstairs again is Yang's room. In here we meet the best NPC in FF4's world, Yang's wife, Sheila. Right now she doesn't seem like much, just thanking Cecil for saving Yang's life and telling him the king wants to talk to him, but she will get better. Next I try the right tower. Nothing on the first floor, the second is another dancer who turns out to be a monk. There's also a Bacchus's wine in one of the pots. The top floor is a king's room containing a tent I take from the chest there. I head back inside and go north instead to enter the throne room. Yang informs the king of the impending attack from Baron. When the king asks if the others can be trusted, Yang backs him up for saving his life and Edward puts himself forward, since being royalty, he already knows the king. Edward manages to convince the king and he has Yang mobilise the men. Edward and Cecil will also fight alongside Yang, while Rosa and Rydia assist the medic with their white magic. Cecil asks Rydia to take care of Rosa and the men head for the front gate. Everyone has their positions and a monk warns them they're here. Through the front gate I get attacked by 2 new enemies, Captain and 2 Baron Marines. This is just like the fight in the inn in Kaipo. The captain will flee if I kill the marines and won't get added to my bestiary, so I make sure to kill him before both marines are dead. After the fight, the castle takes a bombing from the Red Wings, forcing them to retreat inside. Yang apologises after realising they're outnumbered, but Cecil tells him it's far from over. A monster comes in through the door and I fight Aleshi, Domovoy and Sahagin. Yang's 2 lightning claws destroy the Sahagin especially. Edward reaches level 14 from this fight. More enemies force their way in and kill the 2 monks guarding the shop and inn. We get surrounded again, forcing another retreat. But 2 more monks are cornered and left behind. Now they're in front of the throne room, which worries Cecil, but Yang says that the king, the women and the children have been hidden in a safe place. We get attacked again by another captain and 2 more Baron Marines. I've already registered a captain so I don't need to kill this one, but it's more XP so I go for it anyway. Yang reaches level 13 from this fight. Once again we're left retreating and 1 more monk gets caught on the way. The crystal chamber is behind the throne room. Yang has locked the door to the throne room, but the final monk goes and unlocks it. The monk turns out to be the enemy in disguise and attacks. This is just a gargoyle, no problem. We then get attacked by another trio of Leshy, Domovoy and Sahagin. They have no choice but to retreat into the crystal chamber. On the way, Edward trips, forcing a fight to save him. Once again it's a captain and 2 Baron Marines. Once I kill them, they safely retreat to the crystal chamber. Once they place themselves in front of the crystal, Cain shows up. Cecil doesn't think about how suspicious this is and is just happy to see his best friend alive, asking if he's ready to fight alongside him. Instead, Cain is ready to fight against him. Cecil tries to ask what's going on, but Cain just keeps jumping on him until he deals over 2,000 damage more than Cecil's maximum. Cecil reasons that Cain must be under Goldberg's spell, but Cain ignores him and goes for the kill. That's when Rosa and Rydia come in. Seeing Rosa actually makes Cain hesitate, not that it changes anything because Goldberg himself finally makes an appearance. Goldberg chides Cain for hesitating and prepares to finish the job himself. Yang and Edward try to protect Cecil, but Goldberg doesn't care about them and knocks them both out with lightning. Goldberg gets impatient and has Cain bring him the crystal. Rosa begs him to stop, but Cecil shouting Rosa to not get involved gives away that she's important to him, so Goldberg takes her with him in case they need to use her against him in the future. Cain grabs the crystal and threatens that Cecil won't get to live next time. Once Cain leaves, Rydia heals everyone. The men are pretty down, having just lost to Crystal and Rosa after everything they just fought against, but Rydia tries to cheer them up by saying they can just take Rosa and the Crystal back. This helps them realise they don't have time to be miserable, but first they must rest to heal from the long battle. Back in the throne room, I take some Hermes sandals from his pot. An old man says the king rests in his room after being injured in the attack. To the right is a button that opens a door to a hidden passage leading to three chests containing spider silk, the demon shield and an ether. The demon shield completes Cecil's demon armor set. Before going to the inn, I visit Sheila, who off-screen fought off the enemy with just a frying pan. At the inn, the four start planning the rescue. Cecil says they need an airship, but Baron owns all the airships in the world, so they have to sneak in and take one. Baron's sea force is weak since they rely so much on the Red Wings, so they'll sneak in by boat, which Yang will request from the king in the morning. When the subject of Kane comes up and Cecil doesn't know what happened to him, Yang thinks Baron holds the answer to that too. After that, they decide to rest. The next morning, they're speaking with the king. He agrees to lend them a ship. He also gives Cecil a sword that belonged to a dark knight who visited Fabul years ago, the Deathbringer. It's a strong sword that also has a chance of instant killing some enemies. He then says a ship will be at the harbour to the east. Golbez has 3 out of 4 crystals now, so he really needs to be stopped. Nothing else to do but go to that harbour. Sheila sees everyone off while giving them some encouragement and they get going. During the journey, Yang asks what the plan is once they reach Baron. Cecil says they'll meet Cid, certain that he'll help. Meanwhile, Rydia shows concern for Edward after seeing that he's shaking, but he brushes those concerns off. As they approach Baron, the ship starts quaking. A huge whirlpool opens up in the sea with a dragon inside. The sailors recognise it as the Lord of the Sea, Leviathan. There's nothing they can do as Leviathan starts dragging the ship in. The ship takes a hit that knocks Rydia into the ocean, prompting Yang to jump in after her to try and save her. Another hit knocks out Edward. We then get an unexpected placing of the DS version of this scene, where Leviathan sucks the ship into the whirlpool completely. I had no idea these were even in this version. Cecil wakes up alone on the beach, with no sign of the others and no idea if they're even alive. And he's nowhere near Baron. But he did wash up near a village, so at least things aren't all bad for him. Oh. Yeah, Cecil washed up at the worst possible place, and the Mycidians didn't forget the slaughtering they got from him so quickly. The first mage he talks to turns him into a toad. We can look in the inn where there's a poster with some harsh but deserved feelings towards Baron written down. There's a dancer whose dance puts Cecil to sleep. He wakes up as a pig behind the inn, with the dancer revealed to be an old woman. The white mages in town don't seem to care about what Cecil did, talking about other things, except for this one who understandably panics and hides in the trees. Back in the inn, people are split between being afraid of Cecil, willing to pick a fight, or just begging for the release of the prisoners in Baron. The bartender will offer Cecil a drink that turns out to be poisoned. I have an antidote for the poison, but nothing to cure me of pig. So I have the dancer curse me again so the two pig castings cancel each other out. Now I've made Cecil suffer physically for his crimes, it's time to make him do some grovelling. I take him into the Hall of Prayer at the north end of the village and have him talk to the Elder. When the Elder asks why Cecil is here, Cecil owns up to the fact he acted out orders he disagreed with because he didn't have enough courage to disobey. The Elder points out that apologising won't bring back those whose deaths he's responsible for, but he does believe that Cecil's regret is genuine, so he will listen to Cecil's story. Cecil gives a very abridged recap of what brought him to Mycidia. Although, notice that now Rosa's life could be in danger, Cecil lists saving her as his main quest. He doesn't even bring up recovering the crystals. The Elder suggests that Cecil's constant string of bad luck is a test in which he needs to prove himself worthy, but he also points out that relying on the Dark Sword is doing nothing for him but darkening his soul. The solution is to purify himself by climbing Mount Ordeals to the east. Cecil says he can't afford to waste time with another quest with Rosa's life at risk, but he doesn't have a choice. He cannot fight Golbez as a Dark Knight, so he has to climb Mount Ordeals to become a Paladin. Of course, it's not that easy. Everyone else who ever tried has failed and died there. Cecil finally accepts his quest, but doubts he can do it alone, so the Elder calls for the twin mages Palum and Porum. Porum arrives, but there's no Palum. So Porum demands he show himself. So he does. And right away, we see that Palum is the arrogant prodigy with no respect for anyone, and Porum is the incredibly polite, hard-working one. Cecil is just confused that his help is a pair of 5-year-olds. So I now have the party free once again. The other citizens of Mycidia now know of Cecil's quest and they have no faith that the guy who murdered their friends and families could be the one to actually become a paladin. The Elder call the twins prodigies, and their levels reflect that. At just 5 years old, they're experienced enough mages to start at the same level Cecil and Kane started the game at. Palum can equip rods and daggers while Porum has staffs. Both of them can equip my nemesis, the bows. From the weapon shop, I buy a flame rod for Palum. Like the ice rod, it allows for a free casting of fire. I buy Porum a healing staff, which allows for a free casting of cure when used as an item. From the armor shop, I buy both twins a wizard hat each. I also get them both a set of Gaia gear and a silver armlet each. All of these are upgrades over their starting equipment. The rest of it is paladin equipment. It's all expensive, but I can afford a lustrous shield in preparation. Now it's time for the long trek east to Mount Ordeals. I also intend to use the journey to get the twins some levels, since their starting spell selection is very basic. It takes me quite a while to get a random encounter when I'm actually wanting them. My first fight here gets me a new enemy, the Zoo. Cecil actually fought one of these in those automated battles at the start of the game. We also get to see the Deathbringer in action. One hit and the Zoo is dead. Porom and Pelham have their own abilities apart from their magic. Porom has Cry to make enemies easier to steal from. I'd like to come back to this later because that gameplay choice makes no sense in the pre-GBA versions. Pelham has the more useful Bluff, which increases his intelligence stat, which determines black magic damage. I still don't use it that often. They both also have Twin Cast. It makes the two of them cast a single powerful spell. I also rarely use this one because the spell takes an absolute eternity to charge. At the end of my next fight, Porom reaches level 11 and learns Raise, while Pelham reaches the same level and learns Blizzara and Pig. Porom and Pelham learn the same spells that Rosa and Rydia do respectively, but at different levels, as you can see by Pelham having the second tier ice spell at level 11, while Rydia still didn't have it by 15. I actually end up reaching Mount Ordeals, ending up in very few fights. But before I go in, south of the entrance is another Chocobo Forest. I'm just here for the Gasal Greens. On the way to the mountain from the forest, Cecil reaches level 18. I decide to hang outside the Chocobo Forest for a bit, since I can heal and then use the white Chocobo to refill Porom's MP. The twins reach level 12, Porom learning Protect and Pelham learning Fyra. Fyra is what I was wanting. With it, I enter Mount Ordeals. Walking left from the entrance is blocked off by a huge flame. Pelham gets rid of it with Blizzard and takes a chance to gloat. Porom smacks him, reminding him that the Elder taught them not to become arrogant. Meanwhile, we see what Golbez and Kane are up to. They've got Rosa tied up while Golbez calls one of his minions, Scamilione of Earth. Golbez sends him to deal with Cecil, since he knows he's climbing Mount Ordeals and him becoming a paladin is one of very few threats to Golbez. Once Scamilione leaves, Kane believes that even as a Dark Knight, Cecil may still be a challenge. Golbez points out that Scamilione is one of the four elemental archfiends, a term that I think they've changed in nearly every new English version of the game. From simply fiends, to archfiends, to lords of the elements, I'm probably missing a couple. The point is, he's strong. But Kane really wants a second chance at killing Cecil, but Golbez shuts him down like he deserves, telling him that even just guarding Rosa is too good for him. You see, me and this Golbez, we're on the same page when it comes to Kane. Back to Cecil. Mount Ordeal's first screen is simple, just to climb up two sets of stairs to a door and a chest to the right of each set of stairs. In this screen I get the soul, the next tier up from spirit. Bit of a cruel trick actually, majority of the enemies on Mount Ordeals are undead, meaning they have a fire weakness. But souls actually absorb fire instead, and I forget this every single time I play this part. The first chest here just has a potion in it, as does the second. So many chests so far have just had potions, and it's always the most disappointing treasure that isn't more arrows. Going through the door leads to the trail, which is the most simple screen in this place, just a journey north. In here I get two new zombies, Revenant and Wraith. These guys only take one damage from Cecil's sword. This is how the game shows how Cecil being a Dark Knight is holding him back. You get this amazing new Dark Sword that kills things in one hit, but it only lasts about 5 minutes before it's rendered useless and Cecil has to rely on the 5-year-olds to get anywhere. These enemies are why I was after Fyra for Pelham. Even split across 4 enemies, it does a lot of damage to them. From this fight, Porom reaches level 13 and learns Cura, while Pelham also reaches level 13 and learns Fundara. As I approach the northern exit, we see a familiar face wandering around. It's Teller. Teller asks if Cecil is searching for Meteor like he is. It turns out Teller is the one person Pelham respects. Teller is his idol and he wants to become a sage like him. Pelham also almost lets it slip that they're spying on Cecil before Porom shuts him up. After introductions, Teller asks what happened to Rydia and Edward. Cecil lets him know about the Leviathan attack and how they're both dead and that Golbez has Rosa. Cecil brings up that last time, Teller left for Baron to take on Golbez. After he had some time to calm down, Teller realised his spells aren't strong enough for someone like Golbez, so he came here to find Meteor, the most powerful black magic spell. Porom points out that using a spell like Meteor would be too much for a 60-year-old man. Teller knows this but doesn't care. If he has to die to make Golbez pay, then he accepts that. Cecil then fills Teller in on why he's there. All the while, Pelham and Porom have their little side commentary. Pelham doesn't listen to things and needs to be reminded of what's going on. Teller decides to join it with Cecil again, feeling the mountain holds some kind of secret. I then go to the next screen. For this room I go to the far west of my first chest, then backtrack and go northeast, then west again along a bridge to the exit, taking a quick detour south to a second chest. The first chest contains an ether. While a party member first joins at a fixed level, once they leave the party, they always gain a percentage of the experience you gain from battle while they're away. For Teller, that just means he gained a single level off screen and returned at level 21. About 13 years ago, I once wasted days grinding Cecil outside Mount Ordeals and Teller rejoined in the level 40s. It didn't make him that much more useful with his pathetic stats, tiny HP and fixed 90 MP that never increases, but simply seeing Teller at such a high level was itself a bit of a novelty. In my next fight, Porym and Palin reach level 14 and Palin learns Stop. The second chest contains another Aether and I move on to the next screen, the Summit. Nothing interesting about the layout of the Summit. There's a safe space to the east, but the main path forward is just north and west across the bridge. As we travel up the Summit, someone makes a strange noise, which Porym assumes to be Palin at first. It happens again by the stairs. Just as I reach this bridge, I get my first Lilith enemy. She responds to physical attacks with Slap, which inflicts silence on the target. Silence prevents the usage of any ability that requires the character to use their voice, so no chanting for any spells. Killing this one gets Teller to level 22. At the bridge, the noises start again and Scarmiglione reveals himself. He gives a little threat and the fight starts. Scarmiglione also brought four Skullnuts with him, another tier up for the zombies. Of course they had that fire weakness, so they aren't a problem. Scarmiglione himself has no weaknesses and he has 3500 HP. But what he also doesn't have is the resistance to Cecil's Dark Sword that his minions have. So this fight mostly consists of Cecil attacking Scarmiglione directly, while Palom and Teller cast fire and fire respectively on everything, and Porym heals when needed. The Skullnuts go quickly and after that it's just a case of beating Scarmiglione down. He counters every attack by casting Thunder, but the damage it does is nothing compared to the over 400 that Palom's fire does to him. The final casting even manages to go over 600. The XP from this fight brings Cecil to level 19. I know what's coming next, so the first thing I do is return to the safe space to use a tent. On the way back to the bridge, the twins reach level 15 and Porym learns Silence. I cross the bridge, but Scarmiglione isn't done yet. Killing him has made him stronger, so he reappears for another boss fight. This one is a back attack, and the first boss fight in the game to include the game's stronger boss theme, The Dreadful Fight. Actually, this is the first game in the series to include a second boss theme for more important battles. He only gained 25 HP for a total of 3,525, but being undead, he also gained a big fire weakness. Healing items and magic also damage him, but the fire weakness is more important. Palom's fire does over 900 damage to him, that's over a quarter of his HP in one attack. He responds with some status effects, but it's not a problem. Personally, I find Scarmiglione's true form easier than his first, thanks to those added weaknesses, and he dies much quicker than he did the first time. This time he truly is dead. I'm now free to approach this monument. A voice calls Cecil its son and beckons him inside. The voice claims to have been waiting for Cecil for a while to give him its power. It does say that by doing so, that its pain will only grow. A sword lowers from the air and Cecil grabs it, transforming him. But that's only the first step. Cecil has to overcome his past darkness. His Dark Knight self comes out of the mirror and approaches him. The others try to help, but Cecil doesn't let them. He has to do this himself. Now, you can defeat the Dark Knight by outdamaging it, but that is difficult, time and resource consuming, and gets you nothing. Instead, just make Cecil stand there and take the Dark Knight's attacks. After taking three darkness attacks, the voice will ask Cecil what he will fight for with his new power, and the Dark Knight drops dead. The voice once again calls Cecil's son and tells him he must defeat Golbez. Cecil is now officially a paladin. Cecil says that the voice sounded familiar to him, but his thoughts are cut off by Teller. The light jogged Teller's memory of his old spells. It also broke the seal on Meteor and allowed Teller to learn that too. The twins decide it's time to come clean to Cecil about the spying thing, but Teller interrupts them first, fired up to return to Baron and take on Golbez. Cecil takes a few more seconds to ponder why the light called him son and leaves with the others. The change to paladin means Cecil has to start again at level 1, but you can already see the improvement. At level 1 he has 600 HP. Compare this to when he started as a level 10 Dark Knight with only 200 HP. Now he's not a Dark Knight, he's 3 times as durable as he was before. He has white magic, only starting with Cure for now. I also forget to equip him with that lustrous seal that I bought earlier for now. He now goes from dealing only 1 point of damage to the zombie enemies to dealing over 200. Another ability Cecil has is that if the party member's HP is low enough that they use their weakened sprite, Cecil will automatically cover him and take physical hits targeting them for himself. And since he has so much HP, most of the time he can tank it. Of course, being level 1, he needs very little XP to level up. The very first fight after this, Porym and Palin reach level 16, and Cecil goes from level 1 to level 7, learning Sight at level 3. It's a very short and minor section of the game, but Cecil's climb down Mount Ordeals is my favourite part of the game. You have Cecil slowly losing his usefulness, dragging him up this mountain, and then when he finally becomes a paladin, the game shows his improvement by making him so much stronger and more useful at level 1 than he ever was as a Dark Knight pushing level 20. And then it shows that he's only getting better, with multiple level ups in a single fight. I love it. The next fight gets Cecil to level 8 and teaches him Libra. The fight after gets him to level 9. I only had 3 battles before I left Mount Ordeals, and they gained Cecil 8 levels. As for Teller, he got nearly every spell in the game. The issue is that, as I said earlier, his maximum MP is fixed at 90 and never increases. Meteor requires 99 MP, so I can't use it. The highest tier elemental spells, Fireaga, Fundaga and Blizzaga, all cost 30 MP each, so he only has enough for 3 castings before he runs out. He has Curaja, the best healing spell in the game, but only enough MP for two castings. It shows that even though Teller has his spells back, his actual strength and vitality haven't increased. He's still a kind of unfit 60-year-old man. Also, since he now remembers all his spells, he loses a recall ability. After using the white chocobo to fully heal myself, I should be getting back to Mysidia, but I have one more thing I want to do. I finally remember to give Cecil that lustrous shield, since apart from the Mythgraven blade he was given, he only starts with generic clothing equipped. I also give him an iron helm and iron gloves for now. North of Mount Ordeals, I get walking on the west side of these mountains as I keep going north. On this walk, Cecil reaches level 10. Cecil's white magic isn't that useful in terms of the amount he can heal, but I always default to him for healing outside of battle, so I can save my proper healer's MP for when I really need it. Heading all the way north here allows me to fight enemies from the Troia area early. The northernmost tip of the island is considered part of Troia in the game's code. First I fight a Ketshi and Needlehog. Ketshi is the first of the Coil enemy type, infamous for their move Blaster, which can either paralyse or instantly kill the party member it targets, depending on how bad your luck is. The Needlehog is also quite strong for this point. These four regular enemies end up taking longer to kill than Scarmilione's true form. Cecil reaches level 11 from this fight. Next new enemy I'm fighting early is the Etin Snake. These have an ice weakness, so they're much easier to deal with than the other new enemies I've fought. Porom and Palom reach level 17 from this fight. Next there's a Treant. Being made of wood, they're weak to fire, just not to the same extent that the Etin Snake is weak to ice. Cecil reaches level 12. Just hope you don't get back attacked here. That's my first party member KO in this playthrough. Holding the shoulder buttons can let you flee from battle, but you also have a chance of losing some money. Next battle, Cecil reaches level 13. The next new enemy for the beast area is the Maw Blossom. Not much to say, but a Firaka from Teller does over 2,000 damage, the most I've dealt so far. Porom reaches level 18 and learns Berserk, Palom reaches level 18, and Cecil reaches level 14. That was the last enemy I was after, and I also got quite the level boost gaining them, so I head on back to the Mysidia. The people there cannot believe that Cecil actually did it. First thing I do is go in the armor shop. All those fights I did since I left got me the money for a lustrous helm, knight's armor, and gauntlets. These more than double Cecil's defense. Oh yeah, and Cecil can equip bows now, not that it will ever come into play for me. Although most people have had their minds changed, there is still the one guy who can't forgive Cecil. I return to the Elder, who is amazed. The twins say he passed the test, and the Elder comes clean about asking them to spy on him. Cecil understands though, believing they were right to distrust him. The Elder takes an interest in the Mythgraven blade, as it has an ancient Mysidian legend engraved on the blade. Here he is, pause so the flashing blue screen doesn't blind you. There's talk of being born from a dragon, rising over the heavens and the moon's light. We don't know what it means yet. Cecil asks why the light called him Sun, but the Elder has no idea what that's about. The Elder says that for years Mysidians have prayed for the one the legend refers to appear, and that Cecil may be it. Teller gets bored and just wants to get killing Golbez. The Elder and Teller are old friends who haven't seen each other in years. When Palom brings up that Teller has learned Meteor, the Elder gives the same warning Porom did about his age and that spell, and Teller repeats his "I don't care if it kills me" thing. The Elder does believe that the two have a chance against Golbez though, and grants them permission to use the Devil's Road to teleport to Baron. Meanwhile, he will go to the Tower of Prayer and get praying for their success. Cecil and Teller go to leave, and the twins decide to go with them. When the Elder tells them to get back to studying, they very easily convince him to let them go. Cecil seems like he wanted to leave them behind, but they talk him around too. The stairs behind where the Elder was standing lead to Mysidia's crystal chamber. There's then a door in the back to the Tower of Prayer, if you ever want to check in on the Elder again. The Devil's Road is on the east of town, just walk into the light and it teleports you to Baron. Both the Elder and a random white mage in town talk about how draining and difficult to traverse the Devil's Road is, but that amounts to nothing and I just end up there with no trouble. The sequel will expand on this, revealing that the Devil's Road is draining because it's a tedious teleporter dungeon. This game had a better idea skipping it. Back in Baron Town, we can talk to people and find that things have gotten worse. Sid went to the castle, disobeyed the king and hasn't been seen in days, there's a strange monk hanging around at the inn, dancing has been outlawed, and we're just not going to tell Rose's mother what happened to her. But we will check out the inn. In the bar at the back, Yang can be seen sat at a table with two soldiers. Cecil reveals himself to Yang, who calls him a traitor to Baron and has the soldiers try to arrest him. Baron guardsmen respond to physical attacks by casting Mini. Mini not only reduces strength, but also defense, so a single hit deals almost 400 damage to Cecil. I have Teller kill them both with Bio. Next, Yang gets involved. He has 62,000 HP, but we don't have to get rid of all that. Yang will attack twice with Kick, the next hit he takes after this will defeat him. I do get to show off one of the twin cast spells while I wait though, Pyroblast. Not worth the length of time it took to charge. Once defeated, Yang comes to his senses. He can't remember anything after Leviathan. Seems like he wasn't possessed, just amnesiac at his lack of memory exploited by Baron. Cecil asks about Rydir and Edward. Rydir was swallowed by Leviathan, but he doesn't know about Edward. After being informed he made it to Baron, he rejoins the party. The party are given a free night at the inn to talk things through. We go through the usual introductions, during which Palom decides to lay on the guilt for that fight. Cecil moves the conversation along to Cid, they have to sneak into the castle to find him. Luckily, the enemy trusted Yang with the Baron Key, which unlocks a pair of doors in town. While Yang was away, he got himself up to level 18. Him having less HP than Cecil is a rare sight. I give him back his lightning claws and some old armour I was hanging onto. First usage of the Baron Key is to unlock the weapon and armour shop. If you remember, we couldn't get him back at the start of the game. Before I see what they sell, I can walk through the wall in the bottom right corner and get behind the counters for a pair of chests. One has 2,000 gil and the other Azusa's Wrath. I buy a Thunder off of Palom and 3 Kenpo Gi for Yang and the twins. The other door requiring the keys on the west side of town. In this room I can run through the wall on the right to find a chest with 1,000 gil inside, but the rest of this place can wait. I leave town and go back towards the Mist Cave. Teller reaches level 23 on the way. Nothing else happens on the way back through the cave and I return to Mist. The place is still in pretty bad shape. Most of the people here are travellers who don't know the cause behind the fire. I guess the King of Baron never straight up said, "Yeah, burn an innocent village to the ground, it were awesome." I enter the house in the northwest corner, which the sequel will confirm was Rydia's house. I run into the fireplace and find a hidden passage to 3 chests. They have a gold hairpin, clothing, and a ruby ring. Only Porom can equip the gold hairpin right now, which resists lightning. Wanna know something dark? We can pick up the bomb fragments from the bomb ring hidden around town to start even more fires with. There's 3 of these to find. I return to Rydia's house since I forgot something. Past those chests is another hidden passage that takes to 1 more chest containing a polymorph rod. That's all for this place, so I head back to Baron. On the way back, Yang reaches level 19. I also remember to equip Teller with the polymorph rod. I go back through that door and down the stairs into the ancient waterway. This room, B4, is simple. I go south to open the 3 chests, then take the winding path to the exit in the northeast corner. My first fight gets me 2 new enemies, Splasher and Devil's Castanet. Yang is a beast in this dungeon. Most enemies here have a lightning weakness, and giving him 2 lightning claws has him doing 5 times the amount of damage that Cecil does with their normal attacks. There's also Palom's 3 thunders with the thunder rod, which isn't as useful as his Fundara, but still handy. The 3 chests contain a high potion, ether, and Zeus's wrath. My next fight adds another new enemy, Electrofish. They're a trap for someone all decked out in lightning gear because they absorb electric spells, so just freeze them instead. This fight gets Cecil to level 15 and teaches him Cura. I go through the rest of the floor without getting another battle. B3 is a little more complex. I have to go south through a series of hidden passages for the first 2 chests, then east and north to get into the big main area for the 3rd, then east through another hidden passage to a waterfall that takes me to the exit. Next new enemy is the Gigas Gator. Gigas is a cruel joke with that tiny FF2 sprite. As I've got older, I've grown to appreciate Palom especially from a gameplay perspective. As a kid I was impatient and would constantly just run from fights, so he'd always stay underleveled with crap HP and just the basic spells. It wasn't until I was a teenager and actually took on most fights that I saw how quickly he learned good spells. The first chest contains a bronze hourglass. 2 new enemies on my way to the 2nd, Floodworm and Hydra. Thanks to me fighting that Etin Snake from Troyer, I'm actually finding the weaker variant 2nd. The Floodworm has quite a bit of HP, it's the only lightning vulnerable enemy right now to be able to survive a hit from Yang. The twins reach level 19, Porom learns Teleport and Palom learns Bio. I get a Spider Silk from the 2nd chest and Hermes Sandals from the 3rd, Cecil reaches level 16 and I head to the next floor. I shouldn't have to draw my route through B2. It's north with a hidden passage to the left of the exit to a chest. No new enemies, but I should bring up that at this point, Baron Guardsman can be found in random encounters. I get to show off a Polymorph Rod's ability to cast Pig on him. This may be only the 1st or 2nd time in my life I've actually had Pig work on an enemy. The one chest on this floor contains an ether. On to the next. B1 has a save room on the left and the exit on the right. Before I can reach the save room, Yang reaches level 20. In said save room, there's a hidden passage in the northeast corner leading to a chest with an ancient sword inside. It can inflict curse on an enemy, but it's weaker than the Mythgraven blade, so I don't bother. You can also see my weapon selection that Cecil can use staffs too, fitting for someone who can cast white magic. That's something I always forget. I take that exit on the right to end up in the moat behind Baron Castle. I run around the western side to get back within the castle walls and then take the eastern doors into the main hallway. We run into Bygon who welcomes Cecil back. When Cecil asks if Bygon serves Golbez too, Bygon replies that his loyalty is to Baron the Kingdom, nothing else. Cecil asks where Cid is, and Bygon says he was trying to find him too, but his men were attacked and he was the only survivor. And so Bygon joins to help us out, even though we already have a full party. This is such a bad lie that Porom and Palom stop to point out how bad an actor he is. The GBA and PSP versions make it even more obvious, since he doesn't have a portrait in his text boxes. Bygon drops the act, saying Golbez gave him amazing new powers, which he shows for the next boss fight. Bygon is made up of 3 targets, right arm, left arm, and the rest of him. His main body is 4,444 HP and his arms have 444 HP each. I start by making Cecil berserk. Berserk buffs the strength stat in exchange for making the character uncontrollable, only using their normal attack on a random enemy. I take out the left arm just before Bygon casts Reflect on his body. Reflect bounces more spells back at the opposite side. The only spells that bypass Reflect are those considered environmental or all-encompassing, too big for Reflect essentially, such as Quake and Meteor. I take out the right arm, but removing both just lets him regenerate them. So destroying one and leaving the other is the best strategy. I just need to kill one of each to ensure they end up in the bestiary. I then take the chance to berserk Yang too. This spell is also affected by Reflect in this game, which is weird to me since I'm used to it removing Reflect in most games. Bygon's Reflect eventually wears off with time though, and I take the chance to nail him with Firaga before he can put it back up again. After that, it's just waiting for Cecil and Yang to beat him to death. The remaining arm is then burned down. Cecil reaches level 17. Cecil is disappointed that even Bygon, who always seemed loyal, was swayed by Gobez's power. Before I move on, I equip Yang with two Ice Claws and go back and run up to Cecil's room to get a free heal from his bed. When I return to the hallway, I go through the stairs on the right. Now the castle is empty, there's no guard blocking the switch to the treasure vault. Six chests: Aether, Aether, Unicorn Horn, Phoenix Down, Unicorn Horn. This is what the guard was keeping me from? Four consumables and a pair of spell items? I can also enter the East Tower, which was also blocked off earlier. Four chests in here: Hermes Sandals, Bacchus's Wine, Hermes Sandals, Bacchus's Wine. The basement has an elixir in a pot, but when I try going further, an invisible force keeps me from going down to the next floor. So I try floor 2 instead. Two high potions in chests. Floor 3 has an ether in a pot, two tents, and another ether in chests. Now I can finally enter the throne room and confront the king. First he pretends to be all nice, then he says Cecil will be more useful to them as a dark knight instead of a paladin. Then he just straight up drops that he isn't the king. The real king refused to hand over the kingdom, so he killed him before the game started and has been impersonating him since. He's actually the Archfiend of Water, Kanyatso. Boss fight. Kanyatso has 5312 HP. He has a lightning weakness as well as an ice weakness. He'll surround himself in water, which means he's preparing Tsunami, his strongest attack. But it's also when he's the most vulnerable, as it is in first with a lightning spell will do more damage and disperse the water. As shown when Teller's Fundaga does nearly 4,000 damage. This prompts him to hide in his shell and start healing himself, but it doesn't help him because one more whack from Cecil finishes him. He bragged about how much weaker Scarmiglione was, but he's far easier to kill. The twins reach level 20, Porom learning Asuna. After the fight, Cid shows up ready to kick the Fate King's ass for locking him up. Cid is glad to see Cecil alive and Cecil fills him in on what's going on. Cid is pretty pissed about Gorbez taking Rosa, prompting Teller to tell him to stop whining and take him to his airship. The two get in a fight calling each other old, when Cid says he's half Teller's age. It may not be obvious since Cid looks nowhere near as frail as Teller, but he's only 6 years younger than Teller. We get another long string of introductions, with Cid only appreciating Yang for his manners. Cid starts leading everyone to his airship. But in the room connecting the throne room to the main hallway, Kanyatso's spirit gives a chuckle. He still has one last trick, the walls start closing in. The doors are locked too. Porom and Palom position themselves against each wall. Porom tells Cecil how happy she is to have met him and that he's like an older brother to them, along with thanking Teller for what he's taught them. As soon as the walls close in further, they hold themselves against them and cast Break on themselves, petrifying themselves and stopping the walls. Teller tries casting Asuna on them, but since they are stone of their own will, it doesn't work. Teller especially feels guilt over this, feeling that if anyone should have sacrificed themselves, it's the old man and not the 5-year-olds. It just adds them to his list of people to avenge. Gotta say, as a kid, this didn't have much of an effect on me. You don't really think of what it means to be that young when you are so young yourself. It's only as I get older and it really sinks in how young they are, that every time I replay this game, this scene is more and more effective. Plus, it's so common to see the older characters give their lives for the younger generation, that it's quite rare to see it reversed and children are making the sacrifices for people much older. I mean, Cecil at 20 years old is the only one of the four who can be considered young. Yang's 35, so he'd have to die to be considered young. But Cid and Teller are 54 and 60 respectively. The guilt for someone that old to have someone less than a tenth their age give their life for them must be terrible. But it must be bad for Cecil too. Not only did the elder specifically trust them to him, but he didn't even want them to come with him to Baron in the first place. He let them talk him around. Cid declares it time for payback and shows them to the Enterprise. Elsewhere we check back in with Gobez. He comments that Cecil's power has grown. Cain has an idea for the last crystal, which is in a location that's problematic for them. He suggests having Cecil get the crystal for them using Rosa as a bargaining chip. But of course there will be no intention to actually hand Rosa over. Cain goes to make the offer. Rosa tries to get through to him and Cain reveals a bit of motivation, saying that she'll soon see how much better he is than Cecil. This isn't the first hint. There was his comment back in Mist that he isn't just helping Cecil for his sake. Back with the party, Cid takes them through the hidden passage he stashed away at the Enterprise. Sid gets it flying and it rises from the ground. Before we can go anywhere, a Red Wings airship approaches waving a white flag. Kane relays the offer of the Earth Crystal for Rosa. He'll come back when we have the crystal. Cecil tries talking Kane out of it, but it doesn't work. He leaves and the party realises they don't have much choice. Cecil says to go northwest to Troyer, but we're not doing that just yet. So much of the world has opened up now we have an airship, so let's do literally everything else but advance the plot. First I'm going to equip Sid. Since he's close to Teller's age, with a similar amount of experience presumably, he joins at the same level, 20. He's the only party member who can equip hammers. He's another one who can equip bows. I don't know why bows are the most prolific weapon type in the game. Of 12 Pi members in this game, 7 of them can equip bows. Second place is knives, which 6 Pi members can equip. But enough whining about bows, I give Sid some leftover equipment from departed Pi members. This is also the first time since Rosa joined that I'm moving back to the 3 front 2 back formation, now that I have 3 physical fires. There's new dialogue in Baron. Everyone already knows about the fake king situation. People even recognise Cecil and how he's changed. You can also let Sid's daughter know he's safe. Sid won't say anything to her himself though. This time, Cecil will actually dance, if you can call it that, with the dancer. Forgetting about your kidnapped girlfriend already? Given her off-screen feats of physical strength, I wouldn't piss her off. The castle is populated by loyal soldiers again. A lot of them feel stupid for not realising the king was a monster in disguise. One says that all soldier enemies I fought were monsters in disguise, so Cecil never killed any humans. Except Bygon, I suppose. He was human first. One soldier does bring up something though. A woman in town says the king never had any biological children. But he did actually adopt Cecil, which would make him next in line to be king. He already has some support too. The prison is empty, but it's never revealed if the captured Mycidians were freed or if they were executed first. Now it's time to travel the world. Flying directly south of Baron takes me to this island with a huge mountain in the middle and a town just south of it. The town is Agar, where people are descended from dwarves. The first house I visit in the southwest is an observatory. A guy there says this belongs to Corio and it contains the world's best telescope. Actually, it contains the world's only telescope. Corio's wife isn't all that impressed. Corio himself is in the top floor with the telescope. He says that one of the planet's two moons has been having strange activity lately. One moon has no life and no activity like a good moon should, the other has signs of life and has started to turn red. We can even look in the telescope ourselves to compare the moons. In the middle of town is their sacred well, and most people drop hints for later about how there are two sides to everything, dwarf ancestors coming out of the mountain to the north, returning the sun's stone to reveal the path to native land and all that. Another dancer, where the track that plays while she dances is another bit of foreshadowing. There are weapons and armour shops, but nothing useful to buy. The only item here is a single Antarctic wind hidden in some grass. Before I move on from Agar, I have some enemies to kill outside of town. I get a fight with a Rook and a fledgling Rook. These are strong and fast, they deal almost a combined 1000 damage before I even have the chance to act. Sid's unique ability is Analyze. It's useless, just a spell Libra that shows any HP, MP and weaknesses. I will never use it. The enemies here are so strong for me right now that I'm going to the inn after every fight. Next I get a preemptive attack on some Maws. These respond to every attack with re-rays. They also have a ton of HP and a strong physical attack at this point. This fight gets Cecil to level 18. In the forest I get Flamehound and Black Lizard. Black Lizards aren't too bad, but Flamehounds are quite tough and nearly kill Yang before my first turn. But both have ice weaknesses, so Yang and Teller can deal a lot of damage providing they live to get their moves in. Yang reaches level 21 from this fight and finally overtakes Cecil's maximum HP again. Another strong enemy, the Ironback, and this lot back attacks me and kills Yang. The ice weakness still applies though and they don't have much HP, so it's not a big problem. Teller reaches level 24. That's everything in the Agart area, so moving on. Mycidia is east of Agart. I keep going east until I reach Mount Ordeals and then get moving north to this tiny island with another village on it. This is Mithril. Everyone who lives here is either a toad, a pig, or mini. I will say that the PSP sprites didn't do the minis justice. They were actually tiny in the previous versions, not just regular human children like they look here. There's a Mithril staff hidden in the grass on the east side that doesn't get used because Teller's polymorph rod is still better. In this town, the dancers are the Mithril brothers, one of each race that lives here. In the grass behind the weapon shop, there's 5,000 gil. To the east of that is a hidden Mithril knife. The town makes most of its money by mining Mithril and making weapons and armour out of it. What this means is that all the Mithril equipment they sell here is expensive. I get Sid a Mithril hammer and Cecil a Mithril sword, and those two purchases wipe out 2/3 of my funds. They are nice upgrades though. From the armour shop, I get Cecil a Mithril shield, and after selling some old stuff, including that useless Mithril staff I found in the grass, I get a pair of Mithril helms and gloves for Cecil and Sid. I don't have a particular list of endgame items I'd like to own for my perfect save, I just don't want to get rid of any unique or limited items that can't be obtained again. Which is why I still have stuff like Cecil's Dark Knight equipment stored in the Fat Chocobo, even though they will never be used again. Thing is, I don't have an encyclopedic knowledge of which items are limited and which can also be found as rare drops from enemies, so I'm always hanging on to more than I need to. The forest next to the town looks so much like a chocobo forest that it throws me off every time I step in the middle and it turns out not to be one. You can return to Mysidia and let the Elder know about Porom and Palom. Going northwest of Damcyan takes me to this island with a huge hole and with a gigantic tower coming out of it. There's another castle on the south edge of this island. I don't think anyone talks about Eblan by this point in the game, but its castle is already wrecked and lifeless like Damcyan's. First I go into the west tower, then up the stairs. The second floor has a Baxter's wine in a pot. A hidden passage between two pots leads to chests with silencing arrows and 10,000 gil inside. Another hidden exit in the southwest corner puts me back on the first floor where I can grab a bomb core. As for the other chest on the first floor, going right one tile above the door leads to a hidden passage that takes me to it. This is my first monster in a box. Steel Golem and Scourger are new and intended for a stronger party later in the game than this one. They're faster and stronger than any other normal enemies fought so far. By the time one of the four Scourgers is dead, everyone but Teller is at low HP. Luckily, a Thyraga kills the other three and just leaves the Golem. But it doesn't matter, because somehow a casting of Arise to revive Cecil missed and I got my first game over in the playthrough. I dive a second time when, instead of spreading the targets of their attacks out so everyone lasts longer, they all target one party member at a time and kill them all quicker. Third time goes even worse when they kill Teller second, taking out my best damage dealer for this fight. Thing is, I can kill the Scourgers, but by then my party can't stand up to the Golem. But next time I get it, a Thyraga wipes out the Scourgers and then a Blizzaga deals over 4,000 damage and takes out the Steel Golem. But Yang and Cid were knocked out, so they miss out on the experience. Cecil reaches level 19 and learns Teleport. I can now finally claim the treasure, a Sleep Blade. More strength than the Mithril Sword. After getting the other treasures again, I leave and save. That wasn't even the fight that I worry about, so I'm not taking any chances on having to repeat it if I die again. This time I head straight north from the entrance. In this room I can walk through a wall for a chest with a high potion inside. All of the chests have been looted, so I go north again. Can't reach these, so it's north again. In the throne room, left from the throne is a hidden set of stairs. It allows me to grab the unicorn horn and alarm clock from the west side of the previous room. There's another right from the throne room that puts me on the east side. Here I can get a gold needle, maiden's kiss, and a cottage. While tents only heal a certain amount of HP and MP and lose their effectiveness later, cottages always heal the party fully. That just leaves the east tower. Hidden passage in the top left corner leads to a coil whisker. Other one I can't get from here, so I go up to the next floor. Emergency exit and high potion in the first two chests, Hermes sandals in a pot. Then a hidden passage in the top right leads to a monster in a box. We have two coils and the Lamia, both new. Coils respond to physical attacks with Blaster, which ends up being a problem when it instant kills my one guy who doesn't attack physically. Blaster and a series of 300 plus damage hits end up killing me this time. The other chest below the monsters just has a high potion in it. This time I get the horrendous luck of also being back attacked. This time I decide to beat up the Lamia and have Teller cast spells at the coils. But the Lamia responds to physical attacks of Entice, which confuses us. And of course, she goes for Teller. Game over again. Next time I actually use a spell item. That Coil's Whisker I got cast Death, so I use it to take out the Lamia. Then a single Thyraga kills the Coils. Cecil reaches level 20 and Cid reaches level 21 from this fight. The reward is a Blood Lance. No one in my party can equip lances, and this one in particular is one of the most worthless blood weapons in the series. If it looks like I suddenly had a dip in competence in this place, I normally never bother with this place in a casual playthrough. I'm only here this time for the purpose of that perfect save. I make sure to leave and save again because I am not repeating that fight again. At level 20, Cecil has become the first party member to break quadruple digit HP. That's always a big moment for me in a Final Fantasy. That first time someone breaks a thousand is just so good. I return to the second floor of a tower and drop down this hole. It allows me to grab the other chest on the first floor, containing a silver hourglass. Going south puts me in the cellar passage. There's three chests, two with ethers, and one more monster in a box. This is the one I've been dreading, three mad ogres. These guys are beefy, a lot of HP, high strength so they can crush me, and high defenses so they can take most of my attacks. One of these would be a challenge right now, but I have three to deal with. Teller is killed by the first attack, which is a problem because my strategy is reliant on him. What does help is that Cecil's Sleep Sword can put enemies to sleep from a physical attack, so I can slow them down a bit while I try to revive Teller. I manage this after putting all three to sleep, but they wake up and I die. They are vulnerable to break, which can multi-target and instant kill them, but it doesn't always land. I kill two, but it misses the last one, who then kills Teller. Then I get back attacked. The first break takes out the middle one, then the second kills the other two. Three attempts is actually very little compared to how long it took when I tried doing this on the GBA. The prize is a silver apple. One of these permanently increases a character's maximum HP by 50. These are going to be very important when it comes to the perfect save, as most characters don't reach the HP cap naturally. I give it to Cecil since I know that even if he gets the best possible HP gains, he'll still need at least one of these to max out at 9,999. Only Cid and Yang reach the cap naturally. That's it for Eblan, and for side questing in general. Northwest of Baron is a massive forest, and in it, a single spot I can land the airship next to Troyer's town and castle. First, the town. After the inn and the shops, I enter what is essentially a hostess bar. There's a guy who sells a member's writ for 10,000 gil. There's a drunk here who happens to be the only person in this game to mistake Cecil for a woman, which gives me the chance to extend this already overly long video with another anecdote. I didn't think it would get this long, I thought 45 minutes at most. But anyway, as my grandmother was playing through this game back on the PS1, she would constantly mistake Cecil and Rosa for each other in the menus because she thought their 16-bit menu icons were so similar. She would have been somewhere between 49 to 51 at the time, so I guess her sight was starting to worsen a little. I guess if you can't see perfectly clear, you could make that mistake, but back to the game. Upstairs, this place is even more blatantly a hostess bar. There's this one guy going on about an old geezer visiting his Jenny. When I was younger, I never questioned this because I was too young to get what was going on. But whenever I read this line now, I always get thinking, is this guy in a relationship with Jenny, who happens to be a hostess here and is worried about customers being dodgy? Or by my Jenny, is he actually an overly obsessed regular of Jenny's who gets jealous when she has other customers? As for the old geezer he's complaining about, I love this guy. He's not some creep, he just has two hostesses at once because he really wants to brag about his old battles, like the time he killed a goblin, a monster with 6 HP. The hostesses aren't creeped out by him or uncomfortable, they're just bored because it's the only story he has. Also, since the blue-haired woman I can talk to doesn't have a name listed, we can assume that this one I can't get to hear is Jenny. Back on the first floor, I show my members writ, which gets me into the King's Mounted Pub. It's just another dance, but with 10 people spinning in place instead of one. This cost me 10 grand. Yes, I still get a lap dance while your girlfriend is still kidnapped. Also, even though all 10 return to the dressing room, only one remains. I wish those empty chests weren't there. They always make me misremember there being items to get here. Instead, I just blew my Eblan money. To be fair, this time I did remember there was no treasure here. But I'm supposed to be doing everything for this playthrough, and skipping it because I don't care for it wouldn't be in the spirit of this show. In the northeast of town is the Black Chocobo Nursery. Black chocobos can normally fly, but these domesticated ones can't. Flying ones can be found in a nearby forest though. Last thing to do in town is get in the water in the south, follow it north and run through the trees to this meadow where I can find 1000 gil, an ether, a decoy and a dry ether on the ground. Now it's time to check out Troyer Castle. Talking to the soldiers has me learn that if I want to ask about the crystal, I need to talk to the Epopts. When I go inside, another says that a prince from Dancian drifted by and is in the infirmary. We also learn that Troyer is governed entirely by women, even every single soldier here is a woman. Going north again takes me to the Epopts. We can't borrow the crystal because a dark elf already stole it. He fled into a cave northeast with a magnetic barrier that prevents the use of metallic weapons. If we can recover the crystal, they'll let us borrow it. Returning to the previous room and going west takes me to the infirmary, where we can see Edward bedridden. On seeing Cecil is alive, Edward decides to rejoin the party, but Teller shoots that down, saying he's in no condition to fight. Edward takes a chance to apologise for Anna's death, but Teller can't bring himself to give a response. Seeing Yang is also alive gives Edward hope that Riddia survived, but Yang's response gives it away. After being introduced to Cid and realising this means they have an airship, this leads to Cecil informing him of the current situation and the deal with Golbez. When the subject of the Dark Elf comes up, Edward gives Cecil some Whisperweed, saying it's the only way he can still help. On the east side of the castle, it leads to a room with 3 sets of stairs. The middle leads to a room with Bacchus's wine in a pot. The left leads to a treasure vault I don't have permission to enter yet. The right set leads to a switch that opens all 4 of these doors when repeatedly pressed. The HS here contain 2 tents, 2 higher potions, 2 ethers, and 2 ruby rings. All I can do now is head for that cave and after the Dark Elf. But I can't land the airship there. All ground around the cave is covered in forest, which the Enterprise can't land on. My only solution is to head north from Troyer. At the furthest point I can travel is the Chocobo Village. Before I do anything, there are 3 pieces of Gisal Greens hidden here. This forest contains Black Chocobo, which my only means to reach in that cave. Black Chocobos can't fly over mountains, but they can only land in forests. They also stay behind and wait for you when you get off, otherwise I'd be trapped here. The Lodestone Cavern is the final dungeon I'll be covering in this episode. As I enter, that magnetic field takes effect. Anyone equipped with anything metallic will be unable to move in battle. This means Cecil and Cid are the main ones affected. Yang's claws are fine and Teller still has his spells. How this works for me is I just unequip most things and run away from just about every battle until I've dealt with that elf. It also means I'll be skipping any chests that are out of my way. On this first floor, the only battle I stop to take care of are these Mind Flayers. In my experience, Mind Flayers are a rare enemy, so I'd rather take the chance after running into them so quickly. Also these cave bats since they're so weak. The one chest next to the exit here has an ether inside. B2 has me skipping another chest. I go north from the entrance into a room with treasure, then west of the stairs further down. Said treasure room has 2 chests, one with 1000 gil and one with an ether, then it's straight to the next floor with no fights. B3 has me go west into a save room, then south into a treasure room, then west and north to the next room. The treasure room has chests containing a high potion, spider silk, and bronze hourglass. The next door keeps me on B3. This room just has a chest with the fairy claws, which I give straight to Yang, and the stairs to B4. For B4, I follow the bridge around and go east to a save room, then north into the crystal chamber, skipping the chest for now. In this replica crystal chamber, the dark elf is waiting. He's pretty confident taking away my metal will make him the victor. And he's right. He casts all three tier 2 elemental spells and destroys me. Then a tornado to reduce my one survivor to single digits. The party lie defeated, while Edward back in Troy knows this. He forces himself out of bed, collapses, and ignores the doctor's orders to get back in bed to walk to his harp and start playing. The sound from the harp transmits through the whisperweed. It weakens the dark elf and cancels out the magnetic field. I can now finally equip everyone properly again and take on the dark elf once more. He has 23,890 HP, so there's still some sort of twist to this battle. He can still use his triple cast of the aura spells, but they aren't anywhere near as powerful. That magnetic field is a bit of a beginner's trap. You use your newfound freedom with the airship to find this place with very good new equipment. It costs a lot, but it's a decent upgrade. But then the very next dungeon prevents you from using any of it until the very end. They knew what they were doing. Might as well also bring up that the Dark Elf's design is just a straight up reuse of Astos from FF1. Exact same sprites in the PSP versions too. After a few turns, the Dark Elf transforms into a Dark Dragon. He has a more manageable 3,927 HP. The Dark Dragon can easily be killed by casting Tornado on him, which will reduce his HP to 1. That was the strategy I was planning, but of all people, the bastard had turned Teller into a pig in his first form, so it's just beating him to death instead. Not too bad since my three attackers are almost doing 1,000 damage combined per turn. He has a strong physical attack and the move Dark Breath, which deals just over 200 to the entire party. But he only gets to use it once before he dies. Cecil reaches level 21 and Yang reaches level 22. With the elf dead, I can recover the Earth Crystal. Now to leave while collecting the chests and killing the enemies I skipped on the way here. The chest I skipped on B4 is an emergency exit. An enemy I skipped on the way here is the Succubus. This particular enemy formation, 6 bats and a succubus, is the bane of my life. Even if they don't ambush you like they did here, this fight takes forever. All 6 bats get to pull off their blood feast attack and you have to watch that animation every time. Even if you try to escape, you'll have to watch a load of them. But I can't run this time because I have to kill at least one succubus. I can't be asked to count how many blood feasts were performed in this fight alone, but I'm showing the entire thing if you want to have an idea. Cid reaches level 22 from that fight. Next new enemy is the ogre. After fighting a stronger variant of these first in Eblan, I'm not too intimidated. Also, Yang's fairy claws do insane damage to ogres and other giant type monsters. It's one of my favourite weapons in the game thanks to this, giving me a physical attack that hits in the thousands at a time where 200-300 is the normal average. Normally, I make it a point to finish every battle for the XP, but multiple bats are an exception. It's not worth the time. Teller reaches level 25 before I make it off of B4, thanks to the sheer amount of encounters I get there. On B3, Cecil reaches level 22. Another new enemy on that floor is the Cave Nagger. I kill it in one hit. The chest I skipped on B2 was an Aether. Yang reaches level 23 on this floor and finally overtakes Cecil's maximum HP again. Cid also reaches level 23 before I leave his floor. Now Teller is the only guy in the party with less than 1,000 HP, what a loser. An ogre drops a headband when I kill it, so I give it to Yang. It boosts his strength a point while taking a point from defence. It's worth it. The final chest I skipped, back in the first room, has a high potion, and I'm out of there. When getting on a packed black chocobo, it always autopilots back to the forest I got it from. The walk back to Troyer is uneventful. Before returning to the Epops, I go see Edward again for a very easily missed scene. They thank Edward and he explains what exactly happened. When he was a travelling bard, he learned this song that repelled fey creatures, so he assumed it would work on the Dark Elf through the Whisperweed. Teller tells Edward that he finally sees himself what Anna saw in him. It's a shame this scene is optional and so easily missed, as it gives closure to the subplot of Teller's resentment towards Edward and it helps humanise Teller more. Without these little bits, he would just come across as an unpleasant rage machine. Now for the Epops. The celebration is cut short when Kane's voice interrupts demanding the crystal. He'll come to us once we board the airship. That's for next episode though. The last thing to take care of is that I now have permission to raid the storeroom. I go right down there and now have access to 18 chests. High Potion, Remedy, Aether, Dry Aether, Elixir, Echo Herbs, Great Bow, Fire Arrows again, Lightning Arrows, Ice Arrows again, Echo Herbs, Silver Apple, Dry Aether, Aether, Remedy, High Potion. I save the Silver Apple for now. And that's a good chunk of Final Fantasy IV with 32% of the bestiary filled. I had a lot more to say than I was expecting to. I don't think I really need to say anymore, do I? I think it's obvious that the 6 hours I played here were a positive experience, and it would be repetitive of me to just keep saying, "So far I'm really enjoying this," every episode, as if I haven't played this game a million times before and already know exactly how I feel. I'll just leave it here. Next episode will have me meet up with Kane to make the trade for Rosa.